He does not need any introduction, but yes, I request Professor Dr. Akhilesh Prajapati to introduce. Dr. Akhilesh Prajapati is an assistant professor of biotechnology, GSFC University. He has expertise in animal cell culture and cancer biology, and recently he has received 50 lakh funding from GSBTM to conduct research on cancer cell. So I invite Dr. Akhilesh sir to initiate this session and introduce our guest, Dr. Professor Pulaiah sir. Yeah, thank you everyone.
Very good morning, sir.
Morning. Good morning, Akhilesh.
Good morning to all respected teachers, our esteemed invited guests, participants, and my dear colleagues. Welcome on the second day of the international webinar series on plant tissue culture and biotechnology, current trends and future perspectives. Organized by School of Science, GSFC University, and sponsored by GSBTM DST, Government of India. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce our today's first speaker of the session, Professor T. Pulaiah. Professor Pulaiah is currently holding a UGC BSR faculty fellow position in the Department of Botany, Sri Krishna Dev Arya University, Anandpur, Andhra Pradesh. Professor Pulaiah has more than 40 years of teaching and research experience in plant taxonomy, plant tissue culture, medicinal plant research. He obtained his master and PhD degree in botany from Andhra University. After that, he moved to the Moscow State University, Russia, for his postdoctoral studies. Professor Pulaiah has visited various universities, botanical garden in across Europe and United States, almost 17 countries he has visited. Professor Pulaiah held several top positions during his regime after retirement, including Dean Faculty of Life Science, Head of the Department, Board of Study Chairperson, and College Principal. He was also President of the prestigious society, the Indian Botanical Society. At present, he is holding a chair, President of Indian Association of Angiosperm Taxonomy. Professor Pulaiah has published over 49 books, more than 265 peer-reviewed research publications and 35 popular articles in his repute. He is principal investigator of 20 major research projects worth more than 1 crore grant from top funding agencies, including DST, DBT, CSIR, UGC, WWF, BSI, etc. He is a recipient of various prestigious awards, which includes Best Teacher Award by the Andhra government, Professor Maheshwari Gold Medal by the Indian Botanical Society, Professor Tyagi Gold Medal from Indian Association for Angiosperm Taxonomy. He has guided 52 PhDs so far in his tutelage. With this brief introduction, I would like to request all ladies and gentlemen present here, please join me in welcoming Professor Pulaiah for his deliberation. He is going to talk on today in vitro production of secondary metabolites. Welcome, Professor Pulaiah. Over to you, please.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Akhilesh Prajapati. Congratulations for your project. We wish you more success.
Thank
In
you,
fact,
sir.
I'll be talking more on today on plant tissue culture. Yes. Can you share? Please share the screen. Please share the screen. Please share the screen.
It's, I think, shared.
Yeah, please share. Share the screen, please. Yes. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Yes. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Right, okay. Plants are the source of medicines to humans, right, since ages. Well, this, let me come to that point later. Well, since yesterday, Professor Kothare, Professor Anish, and the other experts are talking about biotechnology, the applications of biotechnology, plant tissue culture, both in medical field, basic sciences, environment, agriculture, food and nutrition, biosafety, bioresources, etc.
Professor Kothare, sorry for interruption. Could you please present in
presentation? Maximize. Yeah, is it okay?
Yes, sir, it is okay now.
Right, okay, that's fine. Well, many higher plants are major sources of natural products, which are used as pharmaceuticals, agrochemicals, flavors and fragrance ingredients, food additives, and pesticides. Well, the search for new plant-derived chemicals, for example, now we are in a web of pandemic COVID-19, and we are searching for new plant-derived chemicals for this, which we have not yet found. Perhaps, you know, we hope, you know, that in shortly we may find plant sources for COVID pandemic curing. Well, in search of the alternative production of desirable compounds from plants, biotechnological approaches, specifically plant tissue culture, has been adopted for obtaining high grade, high value medicines. Well, cell suspension culture systems could be used as large scale production for secondary metabolites from plant shell culture lines. Well, before I start, you know, let me hear you all know about secondary metabolites. When I say secondary metabolites, you must also think about, you know, primary metabolites. The metabolites that are involved in photosynthesis and respiration together are called as primary metabolites, whereas secondary metabolites are not involved in these two systems. They are produced outside the system and they are not so essential, but they are used for defense. And these chemicals are used for us, by us, for medicines. Well, let me talk about, you know, some of the plants, you know, which Aklesh Prajapati was telling, he is working on cancer biology and cancer treatment. If you see world movies before 1985, there's hero and heroine dances, but before interval, he coughs and he is taken to hospital. Doctor he puts a serious face and says he will die. And what is the disease? Before 1985, remember, leukemia, blood cancer. And the only medicine for this plant comes from a plant called as Catharanthus rogeus. This is the plant called as Catharanthus rogeus or Vinca rogea. It is called as Vincristine and Vinblastine. Remember, Vincristine and Vinblastine. National Institute of Cancer in Washington, D.C. screened 29,000 species of plants. They could not find alternative for Vincristine and Vinblastine. That is the importance of a plant. And this Vincristine and Vinblastine is a secondary metabolite. Please remember, this plant called as Catharanthus rogeus has more than 130 alkaloids. I repeat, 130 alkaloids. You can just imagine, Vincristine, Vinblastine are two alkaloids. It has 130 alkaloids. You can imagine its value. Each chemical is worth $1 billion. Remember this particular thing. So each metabolite, secondary metabolites. Yeah. Well, Prajapati was working on cancer. This is a plant called as paclitaxel. We are writing a book on Elsevier is bringing out a book on paclitaxel. Maybe another 2-3 months, you know, the book is coming out. It is being published by Elsevier. This is Taxol. Taxol comes from Taxus brevifolia, Taxus other species, Astrotaxus, etc. Well, this comes from a bark. Why tissue culture? Let me tell you two or three examples. This is a plant called as Taxus bucketa, and the Taxol, remember, a kg of Taxol costs 200 crores of rupees. Remember, Taxol used paclitaxel or Taxol or paclitaxel. Only 10 milligrams can cure. Remember, dosage for chemo treatment or chemo treatment. So point is, when this was found in bark, companies removed all the barks from all the Taxus trees. With the result, Taxus species or Taxus plants got vanished from especially Himalayas, Northeast India, etc. So point is, once you extract from the plant, plant disappears. Because it is bark is removed, plant dies. So you should find an alternative. One of the alternative is tissue culture. Remember, why plant tissue culture is needed for high value, high amount of secondary metabolite production. In fact, the production now, the largest production of this particular chemical comes from a company which produces this particular chemical through tissue culture. Remember this particular thing. Second thing, just now I told you about vincristine and blasting. This comes from a plant called as a tropical plant. It is Madagascar periwinkle. It grows only in tropical countries, not in temperate countries. And that too, it takes 2 to 3 years to extract this chemical from the roots, a little from leaves. So it is a prolonged period. So why don't you use tissue culture for secondary metabolite production of these particular chemicals? Well, this is another camptothecin producing plant called as Nothoparasitis pneumoniana. Western Ghats, it is very common, whereas it also comes from Camptotheca cumulata of Nishesia, hope plant. Well, we brought out also a book on camptothecin and camptothecin producing plants by once again published by Elsevier. Well, this is a plant which has once again, remember, Western Ghats, it is very restricted. It is endemic also. It is Mahabaleshwar down to Kerala, but it is population is very less. And it is, once you extract this chemical from this plant, its wood, a plant disappears or plant gets reduced in its population. So one has to find out alternative sources to obtain chemicals from these plants, not from directly plants, but through other resources, other technology, like plant tissue culture. Well, here is a plant, another plant called as Psyllium marianum, Psyllium marium. It is used hepatoprotective agent, anti-carcinogenic, anthrosclerotic also. I'm just enumerating a few plants so that you can understand its importance. Why really? Let me go to another plant. This is Digitalis purpurea. Well, here are dizoxin and dizotoxin. Remember, this is Digitalis purpurea. It's a cardiotonic. Remember, it's a cardiotonic. Digitalin and dizoxin. Well, through tissue culture, digitoxin is, remember, less valued, but whereas dizoxin is highly valued. So what they did was, to the tissue culture medium, they added cells of Digitalis purpurea and added dizotoxin as a medium. To the medium, and that produces a high amount of dizoxin, which is a cardiac glycoside. Remember, so this is what is called as modern methods in selection. Yeah, well, of late, people are using herbal beauty parlors. Remember, one such herbal product is herbal lipstick. This is called as chiconin. Chiconin comes from a plant called as Lithospermum erythroryzon. It occurs in China, Korea, Japan. Once people came to know that this plant gives, herbal lipstick, people have lifted all the plants and then within 2-3 years, plant is gone. How? Then what to do? You need a herbal lipstick, but a plant is disappeared. So Mitsui Petrochemical Corporation, I repeat, Mitsui Petrochemical Corporation in Japan designed a bioreactor of 50,000 liter capacity. I repeat, 50,000 liter capacity, not 1 liter or 250 ml, 50,000 liter capacity. And they culture the cells of Lithospermum erythroryzon. You can see the callus here, Lithospermum erythroyzon suspension cultures, Mitsui Petrochemical Corporation. And they extracted the chemical called as chiconin, which is used as herbal lipstick. Remember, now plant is saved, you can get herbal lipstick. Well, this chiconin is also not only used as herbal lipstick, it's also used as sunburns or other burns medicine. Secondary metabolites tissue culture applications. remember how some examples I told you, I don't say that. Well, of late, you know, people are, when I get, you know, thirsty, I drink water. But when you go out, you know, you buy, you know, Pepsi, Thumbs Up, Coca-Cola, etc. Drink, what is written on the bottle is not mentioned on the bottle. Remember, Pepsi, Thumbs Up, Coca-Cola has chlorpyrifos and phenolphos because they have to protect, you know, from the contamination of antimicrobial. So they added insecticides, chlorpyrifos, phenolphos. For sweetener, they added astardam. Why do you drink, you know, if you drink, you know, daily 200 ml of Pepsi, Coca-Cola, after 1 year you test it, you get cancer. So don't drink, you know, these things. Why you should be beautiful? Why should, how? You drink vitamin C containing nimbu pani or any citrus juices. This is a plant called as nannari. In South India, it is used for cool drink. It has 3-hydroxy-4-methoxybenzaldehyde and it is highly medicinal. It has hepatoprotective, antioxidant, blood purifier, etc. So what I'm talking is, there are many medicinal plants which are, yeah. Well, I went to USA, you know, my son works there. So I went to drugstore, you know, to reduce my tummy. I asked the fellow, do you have, you know, anti-obesity drugs? He has shown, remember, this is a plant called Ascarolema ascendens variety fimbriata. Please remember this plant, I'll come back. Yeah, this is a plant. And he has shown me a drug called as Slima Luma. Remember, Slima Luma. And 30 pills, $22. And what is the plant? What is the plant? Plant is Carolema ascendens. This Carolema ascendens doesn't occur in USA. It occurs in Deccan, you know, in Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, parts of Maharashtra, dry areas. So point is, we have resources, plant resources, zero size. Remember, this is appetite suppressant, anti-obesitic, anti-sclerotic. Well, you know about this particular plant called as Ramaphosa serpentina. It has reserpine and serpentine. It is in violent behavior of the patient is suppressed because of this particular drugs. It has also several alkaloids. And you know, when I was a student in MSc, I went to Eastern Ghats. I could see lots of these plants, you know, in Eastern Ghats. But after 20 years, I took my MSc students to there and I found the numbers are practically disappeared. So point is, these are the plants which are collected by the traders or practical people. This is a plant called as Dioscorea species. Dioscorea has diosgenin. 80 million women use it a day for family planning and birth control pill. It's a $1 billion business. Well, here diosgenin comes from this plant. Only left-handed Dioscoreas have diosgenin. Right-handed twining Dioscoreas have no diosgenin. So remember, it has diosgenin. Well, now plant, when you uproot the tubers, you know, plants are gone. So you have to extract this particular, so they culture the cells of Dioscorea, Deltaidea, Dioscorea, other species to obtain diosgenin so that, you know, family planning birth control pills can be marketed. So remember, these are, this is Phodophyllum hexandrum. Well, I was working with one project, you know, DBT project, one of the professor from Delhi, he came with this project and he was telling that, you know, this Phodophyllum hexandrum has, which occurs in Himalayas, has practically disappeared. Only smugglers are supplying him and he was not able to locate the plant. Yes, so sorry to say. Phodophyllum, remember. Well, I just told you some examples of some medicinal plants. I don't say that these are only plants. There are many more medicinal plants. Well, I told you can extract chemicals from these plants, such plants. I don't say that many more are there. From such plants through tissue culture. How? Well, I told you secondary metabolites. Well, through secondary to tissue culture, you can extract the chemicals either through organized manner or unorganized tissue cultures. Organized tissue cultures are shoot cultures, hairy root cultures, whereas unorganized cultures are callus cultures and suspension cultures. I'll come back one after another. Shoot cultures. Yesterday, Professor S.L. Kothare was telling about how shoots are induced. If you have a high cytokinin, you get shoots. Whereas if you have high auxin, like IAIBA, you get roots. So when you want shoot, why shoot cultures, why root cultures, or why organized cultures? Suppose if the chemical is not obtained in callus or suspension, If it gets only accumulated in differentiated cells like bark, roots, etc., then you have to culture only those shoots. Suppose if the chemical occurs only in shoots, not in callus or in suspension cultures, you have to get only shoots. You have, and grow the shoots, extract the shoots, and then obtain that particular chemical. So shoots, you can obtain adventitious shoot by adding more cytokinin or only cytokinin. Well, one of the limiting factor for this shoot cultures is light associated products may be much more high yielding. So light is a limiting factor, because if you grow in I'll show you the photographs also, illumination is a problem for scale up. Well, I'll come back to that. So here metabolite production is intact plant. As I told you, if it is not obtainable in callus and suspension cultures, you have to go only for shoot culture, because it occurs only in intact plant, not in callus. Well, so introduction and multiplication of shoot cultures, optimization of production through medium manipulations. Remember, tissue culture, as in a Professor Kothari was telling, not so simple. Well, when I started work, I learned from A.L. Mehta, A.R. Mehta from Gujarat University. I sent my student way back in 1980s to Mehta to learn the technique. So point is, it's not so easy. We worked on legumes. Legumes are recalcitrant. Solanums are very responsive, remember. So if you work on recalcitrant plants, they don't respond. My student was telling that in a Texas Becketa, she used 10,000 combinations to obtain callus, but she was not able to get it. So point is that research, you have to find out why we are doing so much of research by either Mehta or Mafatlal Kher or Pankaj. We are working is which medium is useful for obtaining a particular callus or suspension or etc. Or what is the concentration? Is there any combinations, etc.? So the enhancement of metabolite production from intact plants can also be done through these manipulations. Well, here you can see that I can remember this is 250 ml bottle. So you scaling, I told you, scale up is a problem. Lighting is a problem. Once it gets crowded, remember its productivity gets down. So you have to extract and then once again. So batch cultures, please remember, batch cultures, not continuous cultures are possible. So batch cultures are obtained through this culture. That is the number one. The number two, organized cultures is root cultures. Suppose if the chemical, for example, I told you, Catharanthus rogeus or Rhamphala serpentina, the chemical occurs only in roots. So when that secondary metabolites, which is useful to us, is only in roots, so you get only roots, culture only roots. So to get more roots, you get what is called as heavy root cultures by using bacterium called as Agrobacterium rhizogenes. This has auxin, remember, this bacterium introduces auxin gene into the plant, and with the result that the plant produces only roots, not shoots. So gene for auxin synthesis and sensitivity are engineered into plant cells, leading to gravity insensitive. Remember, leaves are always, roots are always gravity sensitive, but here by this method, you can produce gravity insensitive mass root production. They are very useful when the products are in roots. But here also, as I told you, in shoot cultures, aggregation and shear sensitivity are a major problem. Light is not a problem here, because you don't need light for roots. But aggregation and shear sensitivity, because once you get more roots, it gets crowded and production gets less and nutrients also get less. Well, this is what hairy root cultures on a solid, you can grow both either solid medium like this or like this. Well, you can also grow in petri dishes, and you can grow on industrial scale also, like in batch cultures. Remember, here no shoots, only roots. They are gravity insensitive, crowded. Remember, this is in liquid medium. Earlier I have shown you solid medium, here is in liquid medium. Yeah, this you can grow in industrial scale also. Remember, in a bioreactor, you can put in a bioreactor this tray, and you add some roots, and they grow, and add as I told you, Agrobacterium rhizogenes, and you get plenty of these hairy roots. So point is, you can obtain through organized cultures when it the chemical occurs only in roots, not in in CALASAR suspension cultures. Now, coming to unorganized cultures, yesterday Professor Kathare was telling about, tissue culture. CALAS is unorganized mass of cells called as CALAS. Remember, it is a tissue. Unorganized, you can get, through either a wound CALAS or, tissue culture CALAS. Well, here, either if you add 2,4-D or 2,4,5-T, you get a lot of CALAS. Or if you add equimolar amounts of auxin and cytokinin, also you get, CALAS. We in our lab, we used mostly 2,4-D and 2,4,5-T to get CALAS, and it is very easy. But remember, once again, as I told you, in Taxus Baqueta and Taxus Breviifolia, my student tried 10,000 combinations, she could not get CALAS. So remember, response of the plant or response of the cells or tissues is more important. Well, when you add to the medium, especially solid medium, remember for CALAS, solid medium is needed, auxin or auxin cytokinin equimolar amount, it leads to production of CALAS or proliferation mass of cells. But here, remember, once again, as I told you, remember, solid medium, as I told you, is a scale up is limited. So large scale, you cannot go. Remember, this is a CALAS culture. Remember, it is a, once again, you have to go for batch cultures. Remember, you can see there, this is in Hypericum species, beta cyanin and beta lynx. It is a colored substance. Remember, which plants? There are some examples. I'll not say that, this is old data, but still, many more have more come. This is only a list, some of them. So point is, secondary metabolites produced through CALAS cultures, like say, for example, Allium cetirizine, or garlic. Whereas psychosaponin is a cosmeceutical. Remember, you give your beauty, whitener, skin tone. So this is psychosaponins come from plant called as Bipleurium falcatum. Used in CALAS cultures, this chemical have been obtained. Similarly, canavanine, Canavalia insiformis, you have the sword beans. Similarly, pyrethrins. Pyrethrins are a synthetic, natural insecticides also, and they are useful for any other uses. It's Chrysanthemum cinerarifolium. Whereas caffeine, coffee arabica. So instead of growing coffee, you can, through tissue culture also, you can obtain caffeine. Similarly, planetol, croton sublaratus, cryptosin, cryptolispis bucherani. Then sterols. You can obtain sterols also through Eucalyptus tariticanus CALAS cultures. Triterpenes, Glycyrrhiza glabra, glycyrrhizin, for example. Then glycosides, Gymnema silvestre, I hope you remember this plant called as Gymnema silvestre is anti-diabetic. If you put a few leaves of this particular plant in your mouth and chew, and then put sugar, it will not be sweet. So this is gymnemic acid, is a glycoside here, there. So here you can obtain Gymnema silvestre through tissue culture instead of the using the plants. So this is how, through tissue, CALAS culture, they obtain. Similarly, alkaloids, tropane alkaloids, hyoscyamine and atropine, especially perhaps you must be knowing about in eyes, eye drops contain this dilation of the pupil of the eye. Hyoscyamine and atropine, they are used for dilation of the pupil of the eye. This comes from a plant called as Hyoscyamus niger. There's the tropane alkaloids, and it is through CALAS culture can be obtained. Saponins, Panax ginseng. You all know about the Chinese are now winning the gold medals because of this particular plant called as Panax ginseng. So now, of course, doping tests have come, but still they are using this particular plant for strength and vigor. So this is Panax ginseng. Indian ginseng is Vitania somnifera, whereas Chinese ginseng is Panax ginseng. Whereas morphine, you all know about morphine and codeine, Papaver somniferum. So this morphine codeine is obtained by CALAS cultures. Similarly, I have shown just now, Rafflesia serpentina, reserpine is obtained through CALAS cultures. Well, unorganized cultures, the second method of unorganized cultures is cell suspension culture. When CALAS species are agitated in a liquid medium, they tend to break up. Please remember, they tend to break up. Suspensions are much easier to bulk up. I told you, shoot cultures are limited. You can grow only in batch cultures of 250 ml or 1 liter capacity. but you cannot grow more than that because sheer sensitivity, area, nutrients, etc. Whereas suspension cultures is easier. Just so I told you, Shikonin, 50,000 liter capacity. Whereas for shoot cultures, you can go at the maximum of 1 liter only. Whereas here, you can go up to 50,000 liter capacity. For example, Shikonin and Berberine. That is one advantage. Suspension is liquid medium. Cells growing in liquid medium is the point. Well, what is the procedure here? Friable, please remember. Friable, what is friable? Friability is easily separable. Easily separable. When you agitate, you know, remember, the cells get break up and they get separated. Well, they easily goes into suspension cultures. Well, for callus, as I told you, you can add, you know, 2,4-D or low cytokinin. You have to obtain first in a callus. So for callus, semi-solid medium, then you degrade with enzymatic pectinase. Please remember, if you add pectinase, cells get separated and they become individual cells. Enzyme digestion with pectinase. Well, removal of large cell aggregates by sieving. So you obtain this way and then sieve the suspension and then you get single cells. So plating of single cells and small cell aggregates, only viable cells will grow and can be reintroduced in suspension cultures. This is how, you know, the procedure is there. Well, this I have shown you. Here you get callus. Remember, you introduce subculture, sieve, you get smaller cells. Remember, you get suspension cultures. You can either go for plate out or once again suspension cultures. So pick up growing cells and then high producers. So here individual cells which are growing, which are, remember, don't say that, you know, all cells produce the chemical. Some cells may not produce, some cells may not respond, some cells may not grow. So those cells which are growing are those cells which are producing. You can reduce only those cells. How? Why? What is the method? I'll come back to you. Those cells which are producing, those are growing, can be introduced into the, and those which are not growing, those which are not producing, you can leave them. Well, what are the roots of this metabolite synthesis? Rapid growth of suspension cultures in large volumes. I told you just now, Catharanthus rhoeteus takes 2 to 3 years to grow fully so that you can extract the chemical. Whereas in suspension cultures, within 2 to 3 months, you can get the whole lot of amount of chemical substance through tissue culture. So point is that this is easily scalable. The growth and subsequent immobilization. Well, how is it? Immobilization. Well, I told you 50,000 liter capacity. Well, it is just like putting water in a drum, pouring the water into the drum and opening the tap. You grow it, you know, for some time and then open the tap and extract. Then, you know, cells also will move out. So one of the procedure is to immobilize the cells. You add some gel or some matrix in the drum so that, you know, the cells are immobilized and you can extract only chemical. I'll come back about these problems with this later on. So you can immobilize the cells, which are used for production of the compounds for a long time. Many cases, secondary product synthesis typical of intact plant cannot occur in rapidly growing undifferentiated cells. Please remember, cells may divide, grow in number, but it may not produce the chemical substance. For that, it requires some degree of morphological biochemical differentiation. So in such case, you have to use two stage. Say first stage is growing and second stage is production. Two stage, like what you produce, like shoots and roots, two stage. So here also multiplication and then production, two stage. Some cases in one stage only you can obtain, but some stages you have to use two stages. Well, what are the industrially developed plant cell cultures, you know, through suspension cultures? Well, these are some of the examples, which, and there are many more examples. This is Shikonin, Lithosperma erythronium, just now I told you, Mitsui Petrochemical Corporation. Whereas Berberine, Coptis Japanica, Nitrodenko, Japan, Bioma. This is long back, I am talking about 1990s. Whereas here now, you have hundreds of such companies have come. In fact, even Taxol, as I told you, is a chemical, is produced not from plants, more in tissue culture. Peroxidase, you know, Raffanus, Cetavus, Kobe, Japan, Geraniol, Geranium species, Netterman, Rosemary, Cassif, Coleus, Blumei. Coleus are, then Desoxin, as I told you, are from Digitalis, Lineata, Brain. I'm talking about long back in 1991. Well, products that are developed from plant tissue culture through suspension cultures, what are the uses? Well, just now I told you some of them. Let me once again repeat some of them once again. Taxol is cancers, not only ovarian, and many other cancers also. Breast cancer, lung cancer, rectal cancer, colorectal cancer, esophagus cancer, etc. This Taxus brevifolia, Taxus bracteata, Taxus invasiensis, many other Taxus species. We have brought up, we are bringing out a book on Taxus being published by Elsevier. You can read this details of this particular effect along with Professor Jason Chen from New York Medical University, St. John's Medical University, New York. You know, we are bringing out this book. Then, you know, as I told you, Camptothecin, Camptothecin accumulata is also anti-cancer. Notapada is Camptothecin accumulata is a Chinese plant, whereas Notapada is an Indian plant, occurs in Western Ghats. Similarly, Forscholin. Well, we are also writing a book on Forscholin, you know, along with Sami Chemicals, you know, chairman, Dr. Majid. Coleus Forscholin is a multi-billion dollar business. Remember, Majid started with $8, you know, with this particular company, and now he's worth 1,000 crores with this plant. It's a Ayurvedic plant, and now it is a billion-dollar business. It's a cardiotonic. Many other uses are there. Artemisinin. You all must be knowing about Chinese lady who got the Nobel Prize, Qing Gaoshu. Remember, your quinine is not now not active on malarial parasite. So they searched other plants, and they found, you know, Artemisia annua, Qing Gaoshu plant in Chinese. Artemisinin is obtained from this plant through tissue culture. So now instead of obtaining from the plants, they are obtaining through tissue culture. Similarly, Castanus spermium and hypericin are used from obtained from Castanus spermium australia and Hypericum esculentum in AIDS treatment. Well, you all know about this suspension cultures, slow rotary shaker at 300 RPM for this for suspension cultures. Well, when you come to, remember when you grow the cells in a medium, you know, they may not respond or they may produce in low quantity. Then you have to add substances which enhance the production of these particular chemicals. What are those substances called as illicit? They are called as elicitors. Elicitors are those substances or products or situations where you can enhance the production of the secondary metabolites. For example, chemicals I am talking, let me, they may be abiotic and biotic also. So here, agmelacin, for example, Cathranthus rhodius, Cathranthin is an anti-cancer drug. Diethyl, aminoethyl, dichlorophenyl ether can be added to elicit more production. Echinopyran, lithospermum, erythroraisin, activated carbon. Glycerin, glycerin max, laminarin, disotonin, polytron is used. Then flavonoid glycosides, haplopappus, gracilis, UV light. Remember, I told you abiotic. Berberine, thalictum, rugosum, ethaphon is as you added to the medium. Caffeine, Caffe arabica, ethaphon is added. Pisatin, Phaseolus vulgaris, glutathione, claventone, Phaseolus vulgaris, denatured RNA is added. Well, that is abiotic elicitors. You can also use biotic elicitors, like, you know, for example, fungal macerated extract. Don't add fungus directly to the medium. You grow the fungus in a separate medium, take the mycelial or cell extracts or filtrates, and then add to the tissue culture medium or secondary metabolite production, not directly the mycelium. So by adding the extracts of the mycelial or cell extracts or filtrates, you can in large quantities this chemical secondary metabolites. For example, thiophene from Tacitus spatula by adding Fusarium conglomeratum, sanguinarin, astrolgia by adding Fusarium oxysporum and Penicillium, diazgenin, I told you, family planning and birth control comes from Diascaria deltoidea. 80 million women use it a day as family planning and birth control pill. Rhizophus oryzus is added. Benzofurans, Agitin, Adenophora, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, the yeast is added. Berberine, Thalictrum rugosum, Saccharomyces cerevisiae is added. Tropane alkaloids, I just now told you. Yeah, it's also obtained from Datura stramonium, Phytophthora megasperma is added, Agmelacin, Cathranthus rhodius, Micromucor, Furunochromarin, Petrosilium artense, Medicarpin, Cicera retinum, Ascochyta rabis is added, Phytotubera and Nicotiana tabacum, Pseudomonas solanaceae is added, Capsaicin. Remember, in your chilies, the substance that is very pungent is capsaicin, but it is highly medicinal. Capsicum annuum, Gliocladium aliaquensis is added to the medium anthraquinone. Noni. Morinda citrifolia. Please remember, Morinda citrifolia is called as noni. Aspergillus has a Niger is added to the medium to so that you can elicit more chemical substance. Anthocyanin is Dacca scarota. You all know about Aspergillus rhizopus is added for this medium, right? Well, I told you about elicit. How do you do it? What are the elicitors that are added? Remember. Well, what are the factors that influence secondary metabolite production? Well, I told you, if you just now put in liquid medium and then put plant cells, they may not produce. So what are the factors that are responsible or that are the control or regulate this particular secondary metabolite production? Strain improvement. I told you some cells may produce, some cells may not produce. Some cells may grow, some cells may not grow. So selection screening is more important. Medium variation. Just like yesterday, S.L. Kothari was telling, some media are used for multiplication, some growth hormones are added. So nutrients, if you add in a particular nutrient, you know, it may produce more chemical secondary metabolite, whereas if you don't add, you know, it may not produce. So point is nutrients. Phytohormones, as you know, auxins, cytokinins, gibberellins, etc., they also influence the production of the secondary metabolites. Precursors, just now I told you, dizitoxin to dizoxin is, dizitoxin is a cheaper material, whereas dizoxin is costly material. So you add cheaper precursors so that the plant produces or the cells produce high value product. Similarly, anti-metabolites also is sometimes problematic, so one has to find out what are the anti-metabolites. Whereas culture conditions, inoculum size, pH, remember, this is very important. For all our plant tissue cultures, we use 5.6 to 5.8 pH, but sometimes, it may be variable. Temperature, our teachers, tell students that 20 to 25 degrees centigrade is optimum for tissue culture, but not all suspension cultures may respond to this. So one has to find out not what temperature it responds well for secondary production, metabolite production. Similarly, light is, some plants need light for production of secondary metabolite, some type of plants don't need. Well, coming to the next point is agitation. This is more important. All suspension cultures need agitation because it needs aeration. Whereas solid medium, it gets both air and then medium. Whereas in liquid medium, the cell gets suspended or it gets submerged, then it will die. So you have to provide aeration, and for that agitation is needed. So the reactors, type of reactors is also important because they may be shear sensitive also. Specialized techniques are used for production. For example, elicitor, just now I told you, immobilization, I also told you, permeabilization. What is this permeabilization? Let me tell you here the problem. When you culture the cells, cells produce secondary metabolite, but this secondary metabolite may not be released into the medium. It stores, it will not release. So you have to kill the cell and get the secondary metabolite. But sometimes if you add to the medium permeabilizing agent, that cell releases that chemical into the medium. So you can keep the cell and obtain the chemical. So this is what is called as permeabilization. Then two-phase system. Just now I told you, some plants, cells, they grow only, but they're not produced. Whereas in other medium, it produces but not grow. So this is two-phase systems and two-stage systems you can use for obtaining secondary metabolites. I told you just now, what are the factors? What are the factors? They are affected by nutrient composition of the medium. For example, phosphate, nitrogen, sulfate. These are the nutrient, what are the composition? Remember, for example, nitrogen, whether you are using in nitrate form or ammonia form. Similarly, they are also affected by carbohydrate growth regulators. For example, 2,4-D may inhibit. Or carbohydrates, whether you are using the sucrose or sometimes it may not be responsive. So exogenous supplement of these precursors may also yield, just now I told you, dizotoxin. Whereas batch cultures are used when you are growing in a small amounts, for example, 250 liter. Or in bioreactor, you can grow in large scale, continuous culture. So either you can use either batch cultures, if it is two-stage systems, or in continuous cultures, it is one-stage systems. Biodegradation, in limiting biodegradation process is a problem. Well, as I told you, factors which are environmental factors also affect production. For example, flavonoids, polyphenols, carotenoids, plastoquinones are stimulated by light. Please remember, light. White and blue light may inhibit alkaloid biosynthesis. Please remember, alkaloid biosynthesis maybe. I'm not talking about, you know, all the plants. Some plants it may happen like this. So white and blue light may not be. So you have to use then red light. Whereas temperature also may limit or limit alkaloid biosynthesis in tobacco is dependent on the temperature variations. Similarly, selection of specific cell lines. I told you just now, some cells may produce, some cells may not produce. So you have to use only those cells which are producing. So heterogeneity of the cultured plant cells, single cell cloning is useful for producing this product analysis, and then use that particular cell for producing. Well, this, all of you, the cells, the students, you know, who are in MSA, they know about this growth curve. Point is, the plant which you are culturing may produce the secondary metabolite at, remember, log phase or, you know, flattened phase. So point is, at what phase or at what stage it is producing more chemical, that at that you have to first experiment and then extract that chemical at that point of time. So point is, you have to grow. Here it only grows. Remember, here also it grows exponentially. It may produce chemical either here or here. The point is, where it is producing chemical, that you have to use. Suppose if it is only increasing the number, not producing, then you have to go to two-stage systems. Stationary nutrients, you have to see all this process. Well, plant cells in suspension cultures, are they enlarged? I have seen in my own lab, you know, suspension culture cells are large. They tend to aggregate, shear. Remember, they aggregate. So you have to add pectinase or something. Shear sensitive. When you are shaking, you know, they may break. They may be slow growing. They are easily contaminated. Please remember, they have low oxygen demand. They will not tolerate anaerobic conditions. So you have to continuously shaking. Can grow to high cell densities. So once, you know, a maximum density is reached, you have to extract, or you have to take out the medium. So they can form very viscous solutions. Remember, when the concentration of the cells increase, it forms viscous. Then you have to extract the chemical. Well, shear in plant cells. Oxygen demand is proportional to cell density. Remember, once there are more organisms, it needs more oxygen. So here also, once there are more cells, more oxygen is needed. Shear rate is proportional to viscosity. Shear rate is proportional to the power of the viscosity also. Not only proportional to viscosity, but also power of the viscosity. Well, these are the factors, and you have to, one has to do research, you know, a particular chemical, particular plant, particular method, and then only go for production line. So one has to, so that for that, all your research, those who are researchers who are listening to me, those who are students who want to come to research, you have to work on these things before you go for production. Well, secondary metabolites obtained through tissue culture, some of the examples are steviocyte. You all know about this particular plant, Stevia rhabdiana, is a 300 times sweeter than your sugar. It is a plant called, comes from South America. It is a sweetener. So instead of growing the plants, you can obtain this steviocyte through tissue culture. Jasmine, your fragrance, perfume, jasmine and species, you can use tissue culture and obtain perfumes. Codeine, papaver somniferum, is analgesic. I told you, morphine and codeine is analgesic. It can be obtained through tissue culture of, instead of growing the plants, then you can obtain through tissue culture. Atropine, just now I told you, muscle relaxant, Atropa belladonna. You can obtain this through tissue culture. Morphine, just now I told you, papaver somniferum. Quinine, Cinchona officinalis, Cinchona saxirubrax, Cinchona calicia. It is anti-malarial, but of course, as I told you just now, quinine is now not, the malarial parasite has become resistant. So you have to now use artemisinin from, obtained from Artemisia annua, Artemisia, other species. Taxol, just now I told you, paclitaxel, Taxus bucketa, Taxus brevifolia, Taxus unionensis, etc. Several anti-cancer problems. And nicotine, Nicotiana tabacum is insecticidal. Catharanthine, Catharanthus rhodes, just now, 130 alkaloids, I told you, anti-cancerous. Quinones, Cinchona, just now I told you. Chiconin, I told you about Lithosperm erythroryzan, cosmeceutical herbal lipstick. Cyclosaponin, this is also photoprotective. If you want to be, you know, white glow, falcatum, cyclosaponin, diazgenin, cardiotonic, diascoria, deltadia. As I told you, is a family planning and birth control pill also it can be used. Well, how can you increase the product formation? Well, how do you go about it? Select. Remember, I told you, select which cell which is producing or which is growing. Start off with the producing part. Suppose if the producing part is the root, take root. If the producing part is shoot, take root. If the producing part is a leaf, take that part and then culture. Modify the media for growth and product formation. I told you, growth and product formation may be one, maybe two different. Then one stage or two stage, you have to find out. Feed precursors for intermediates. For example, bioconversion, digitoxin to desoxin. Produce plant-like conditions. For example, immobilization. I told you the method. Selection. How do you select? Select at the level of the intact plant. Select in culture. Single cells in selection unit. Possible to plate out 1 million cells in a petri dish. Progressive selection in a number by number. Well, selection can be done either positive, negative, visual, analytical. Visual by color. Well, positive collection as to the medium toxic compound like proline or calcium. Won't those cells grow in the presence of the selective give colonies? Plate out the pick of the growing colonies. And then possible to remember here, select only one colony from millions of cells. Needs strong selection pressure. So those cells which are dying, leave it. Those cells which are growing, take out the end. So proline, so positive selection this is. Negative selection, add an agent that kills the dividing cells. Remember, for example, chlorated. Plate out those cells which are suitable time, wash out, and then the other cells which are not growing. So, and then culture those. So use for azotrophs. Azotrophs. Azotrophs are nutrient lines which need special medium content. Remember, concentrations are product, concentrations are needs, chemical substances. Well, visual selection, you know, can be done either, for example, visual colored fluorescent compounds like chiconin, berberine, some alkaloids. Plate out about 50,000, Amrita, plate out about 50,000 cells per plate. Pick up colored fluorescent compounds. Possible to screen about 1 lakh cells in a day's work. So remember, only useful colored fluorescent compounds, chiconin, berberine, some alkaloids are obtained. Plate out 50,000 cells. Pick up colored fluorescent compounds. Possible to screen about 1 million cells in a day's work, remember. Analytical screening. Well, this is a laborious process and costly also. Cut each piece callus into two. One half is subculture, other half extracted and then tested whether it is producing or not. So if it is producing, the other half used for tissue culture. Well, immobilization cell systems. Well, here, let me tell you just example one. And I told you, you can use a drum. Yes, remember, a bioreactor is just a drum where you can pour the medium and then open the tap and then get it. So there you put a drum, put a medium, add the cells, grow it, tap out it. But here, when you open the tap, you know, you get cells also. So you need cells, but you need a chemical. So you have to immobilize the cells. Cells are physically entrapped in a gel culture and products can diffuse from immobilized cells by entrapment. Remember, immobilization either in calcium alginate or potassium carrageenan or in agarose beads. Advantages is automatic physical separation of product from cells. This is, remember, and it is reusable and extensive biomass also. So remember, you have to keep the cell but obtain the chemical. So that is used for by immobilization. It results in continuous operation. Well, stabilization of biocatalyst producing cells. Remember, this is immobilization. Just now I told you, aerated cultures, immobilization. Well, this is immobilization of aerated cultures, immobilization. Well, polymers also can be, cells also can be immobilized. For example, polyacrylamide, epoxy resin, polyurethane. Well, cellulose, agar, agarose, ketosan, alginate. Proteins also can be used for collagen, gelatin, fibrin. Well, these are some of the immobilization materials. Any plant cell that is preserved for viability, remember, it is rapidly growing and it is possible. A different approach to allow cells to become entrapped within the space of preformed bags like nylon, polyurethane, and metal mesh. viability test must be done after immobilization, whether cell is died or it is still living. Well, some product release, continuous cultivation cells can only be applied to extracellular products. Just now I told you, when the cell produces the chemical substance, it may not release into the medium. That is product. So products normally stored within the cells leak out into the medium. If not, I told you, permeability, if not induced to release, secondary products are often stored within the vacuoles and polymerizing agents like DMSO needed for release. Suppose when it is not releasing, even after adding permeabilization agent, you have to destroy the cells. You have to take out the cells and then extract the chemical substance. Sorry for interruption. Well, biotransformation. Well, cells may not produce. Well, you have to add a gene, specifically a particular gene. So gene manipulations or gene biotransformation. So one has to, well, how do this done? And then, well, coming to conversion of small product molecule into composition, industrial important is what is called as this biological systems, is inexpensive precursor is added to the medium. Just now I told you, digitoxin to desoxin. And this is possible through either oxidation, reduction. So add one chemical, either OH or CH3 or any other thing. So any of these means is possible through tissue culture. So low value product is added to the medium, culture, and then obtain a high value product. So select specific cell lines which are specifically characterized, desired reaction or contamination with other products. Well, what are the these methods, right, for catalytic methods? Well, you can call as catalytic, and here I am. Trisia ternatia ellipticine for production of this ellipticine, 5-formyl ellipticine production is added. Gallium oligo, 2-succinyl benzoate anthraquinones are added for hydroxylated production. Similarly, in solanum tuberosum, solaminotone production, precursor is added. Similarly, in carvaxium to carvaxone production, nicotiana tabacum cells are added. Valencine to nucatone production, citrus species is added. Similarly, just now I told you, digitoxin to desoxin, digitalis lineata. So digitoxin is a precursor or low-value products, whereas desoxin is a high-value product. Well, special reactors for plant cell suspension cultures. Well, what are the different types of cells cultures? Modified strut tank reactors, airlift reactors, airloop reactors, bubble column reactors, rotating drum reactors. Perhaps some of the teachers might have already heard this particular thing. Let me show you. This is modified strut tank reactors. Well, this is Ruston tube, just like you use your curd, you make it a buttermilk that is used. This is another simple method. So it is a standard Ruston turbine, wingman impeller. This is airlift system. You put the air bubbles at the bottom and that bubbles come up. This is bubble column reactor, sorry.
Yeah, thank you, sir. The session, is there any question to is there any question to Professor Pullaiya?
Yeah, these are the rotating drum reactors. Yeah. Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so.
Any questions?
I request IDM, could you please put Hitesh, Nakum, Kiran Tark, and Par Desai in panelist mode so that they can interact with Professor Pullaiya?
Yes, please.
In their video, audio, video.
Yes, please. Any questions?
Yeah, sir, just a minute.
Yeah, please.
Hello.
Yeah, yes, please.
Hello, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
the question in the box also. सर आप ये बताएं कि जैसे अगर हम मोगरा के प्लांट में जो फ्लावर्स में जो फ्रेग्रेंट होती है उसके लिए हम ये सही रहेगा कि उसके पेटल्स को हम कल्चर करें एंड देन वी एक्सट्रैक्ट.
I am not so proficient in Hindi. Can you speak, you know, in English so that I can understand it more better? Yeah, please. Yeah.
Is it will be right strategy to grow the petals for the fragrant molecules present in the mogra flower? Yes.
That's why that's what I said that the product Amrita. Bite kira. So, point is. As I told you just now, the part that is producing that particular chemical substance is used for tissue culture. Well, economically, suppose, you know, as I told you, perfumes can be obtained through tissue culture of Amrita Talpi.
Okay. Talpi.
Perfumes can be, say, all whatever these products are, which I am telling you is when it is economically viable. For example, I told you, chiconin. It takes a lot of time for producing, so you can use through reactors. Suppose if the fragrances that is obtained through plants, you know, is economically viable, don't go for tissue culture. If the plant, for example, in America, you want a jasminum fragrance. Remember, jasminum fragrance is not obtained in Europe or America, so you have to grow. You have to go for tissue culture only. So there is no other alternative. So that case, the plant. The part that is producing petals or flowers are used for producing this particular chemicals so that it can be enhanced. So product, that particular part is used. Am I right? Okay.
Sir, will you throw light on the factors affecting for the production?
Yeah. Remember, see, all plant tissue culture research is for various things. Number one is medium manipulation. For example, yesterday Professor Kothari was telling MS medium used for micro propagation. But for this suspension cultures, sometimes, you know, MS medium may or may not. So research is that one. So medium manipulation. So whether it is nitrogen, phosphorus, or other phosphates, etc., is more important. Then growth hormones. So all research, you know, all tissue culture research or publications is for that purpose only. You have to go on industrial scale. So that is medium manipulation. Then precursor. Then light system. Then other things also, for example, elicitor. What are the elicitors? Then, you know, cell, some cells may produce, some cells may not produce. So selection has to be done. So all these are responses. These are some of the factors which I enumerated already, right? You can
thank
see.
You.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Yeah. Akhilesh?
Yes, sir.
Any other question?
Yeah, sir. Just.
Hello.
Sir, few questions in chat box.
Yeah, yes, please.
Sir, myself Parth Desai from Anand Agriculture University.
Please.
Sir, my question is how to subculture the suspension culture flowers. We are working on date palm somatic embryogenesis.
Right.
And for refinement of growth stages of various plant tissue culture stages, we are doing suspension cultures.
Right.
So often I am intervened by subculturing of this date palm suspension culture often get contaminated with.
Yes. Mm-hmm. The point is, this subculturing, you know, especially suspension cultures, is not always, you know, so easy. You have your medium contamination is a problem. You have to suppose if you culture a bark or colored material, phenolics will come out, and those phenolics, you know, are they harm also our growth. So. And suspension cultures, you cannot grow continuously. You have to keep on subculturing. So for example, even tissue culture also, micropropagation. If you go on, you know, reculturing, you know, sometimes they're not being responsive. So you have to subculture. So that's why in suspension cultures, you have to maintain a separate callus cultures and then bring from that. Remember, this is. And then also you have to maintain a shoot culture or root culture where you are getting explant from that source. So you have to simultaneously, you have to maintain, get from them. And then, you know, one has to do research so that, you know, suspension cultures, you know, for micropropagation is you may not get true to type because you may get, you know, some clonal variations also. Micropropagation is always, you know, axillary branching is recommended. But sometimes, you know, you may get, you know, through suspension cultures, large number of somatic embryos. It is possible. One has to reculture only. That is the only method that I can suggest, right?
One method, sir, we are using here is we are sieving with 50 micrometer and 100 micrometer sieve, which right. are available with various brands.
Right.
But doing in this manner also, we are getting contamination in our culture. So is there any specific method, sir, you recommend that?
Remember, you have to analyze the contaminant also. You have to analyze the okay. contaminant, whether it is bacterial, fungal, or any other. And you have to use that particular, that is the experiment. In fact, what is the antibiotic, you know, so you may add antibiotics also. You have to go on testing what is which antibiotic, you know, is kills, you know, this particular microorganism. So you have to analyze which organism is growing in your medium. And then, you know, another thing also. Point is, when you are taking the explant, perhaps this must have come from the explant source also. So be careful about the explant source, you know, endogenous endomycorrhiza or endobacteria may be there. So check at that point also. Then in tissue culture, suppose if it is repeatedly getting, you have to add, you know, the antibiotics or, you know, other agents, you know, which can kill these microorganisms. There's only method that I suggest. Okay. Try. That is all research which we have done.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Most welcome. Antibiotics. Yeah. Try.
Sir, next question from Dr. Nisha Dakshani. She has a saline, Gymnema silvestre. Then how it will affect or useful for secondary metabolite production?
Which one? Repeat.
Sir, Dr. Nisha Dakshani is there. She is having one question about cell line of Gymnema silvestris. So whether it is having any effect, because long-term culture of cell line and it's
definitely
effect on secondary metabolite production.
Definitely. Remember, different cells, different plants respond differently. So this plant, particular plant, must have also have different mechanisms for this particular problem, right?
Okay. Thank you, Professor Pulaiya, for this wonderful talk. So,
yeah,
Professor Pulaiya. Yeah.
Oh, hold on. Pulaiya.tamineni@gmail.com. pulaiah.tamineni@gmail.com email. Well, you can send messages also. 9440505664. I repeat, 9440505664. Pulaiya.tamineni. Most welcome for questions for academic matters. We can discuss. Those who have just now asked, if you have clarification is not satisfactory to you, send a mail to me. Pulaiya.tamineni@gmail. Not only Akhilesh, I also request to all the participants. Akhilesh.
Yes, sir.
Share the.
Yes, sir. I will share email ID and phone number.
Not only mine, at least email IDs. Phone numbers you may not share, but you know, email IDs, please share with all the participants so that, you know, they may get more. Some of the students may be shy to ask questions. So please share the email IDs so that, you know, they can send the questions to us.
Okay, sir. I'll share with all the participants.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Pulaiya, for covering the importance of several medicinal plants and providing historical background of the production of secondary metabolites. Indeed, there are several secondary metabolites, which are commercially produced, as you have talked about Toxol, famous anti-cancer compound. Professor Pulaiya has also covered several techniques of which can be explored for secondary metabolites production and synthesis, and also provide excellent comparison of about advantage of suspension culture over shoot culture. Thank you, sir, for your wonderful talk on secondary metabolites.
Thank you, Akhilesh. And then thank you, Mafatlal Kher and other dignitaries of the university for giving me opportunity to share my experience. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
So, participants, moving to the next speaker of today's webinar. Our second speaker of the session is Professor Mahipal Singh Shekhawat. I welcome Mahipal, Professor Shekhawat. Professor Shekhawat is an assistant professor in plant sorry, it is Associate Professor of Plant Biotechnology at Department of Botany, KM Government Institute of Postgraduate Studies and Research, Puducherry, a city of beautiful beaches and full of greenery. Professor Shekhawat has worked as a postdoctoral research associate at Jain Anand Vyas University, Jodhpur, Rajasthan, and also he served as a senior scientific officer at Center for Research and Application in Plant Tissue Culture, Hisar, Haryana. Dr. Shekhawat has more than 20 years of research experience in plant biotechnology with specialization in the area of in vitro plant biology and production of secondary metabolites. He has several research papers as a he has several research projects as a PI for UGC, DST, DBT, Ayush Ministry, worth rupees more than 60 lakh. He has published over 148 publications and 5 books in his repute. Also served as a potential reviewer for many prestigious scientific journals. Professor Shekhawat has also filed 2 Indian patents. Professor Shekhawat will deliver today his talk on current trends in plant tissue culture technologies. With this brief introduction, I welcome Dr. Shekhawat and invite him for his deliberation. Professor Shekhawat, over to you, please.
Thank you, Pujabhati.
Yes, sir, please.
Is it audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Right. So, at the outset, I would like to thank again the JSFC University, Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Sir, Provost, Deans, Head of the Department of Biotechnology, Faculty Members of Biotechnology Department, and Convener Dr. Mafatlal Ji Khair, Scholars, Students, Participants from India and abroad. Professor T. Pulia, sir. Sir, vanakkam, sir. Happy to see you here, sir. Really nice. I enjoyed your lecture, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, most welcome, most welcome. Thank you for your appreciation. Thank you. I forgot to tell you also, many people, we have written more than 100 books. All of you, please join us to writing books.
Yes, sir. We are part of that, sir. I can see in background, your background books.
Yeah, they are all my books.
Excited.
100 books.
Sir, we will be part of this project, sir.
Right, certainly.
Thank you. Certainly. Thank you, sir. Congratulations, sir.
Certainly.
So, thank you. So, after yesterday's presentation, due to paucity of the time, I received some messages also, even email also, that something extra should be added there. And I think I am fortunate enough that the organizers gave me an opportunity to again share my research experience in other aspects of plant cell and tissue culture technology. So thank you very much, Mafatlal Ji. Yesterday's discussion was basically how we can improve tissue culture technology for the industrial aspect we had discussed. Today's discussion I would like to have for the budding researchers, especially students who want to pursue research in the field of plant cell and tissue culture technology, the research scholars who are doing this at present, and the budding scientists, research community, that what are the recent trends or recent type of chemicals and recently novel type of chemicals and tools and technologies we are using or we can use in plant cell and tissue culture as a research tool for the enhanced production, healthy production of plantlets or shoots or good rooting, and with the maximum survivability under the ex vitro and field conditions. So young friends, this is for you. Enjoy the task. I hope you will enjoy this. So with the basics of plant tissue culture, again with a few introductory, after that we'll start. As we know that it is also known as micropropagation, cloning of plants, in vitro regeneration, organogenesis, somatic embryogenesis, direct, indirect, various methodologies are there. Based on the plant systems, we are using that methodology. And in vitro regeneration is having certain fixed stages are also there. Selection of explant, induction of shoots, creation of cultures, shoots we have to multiply, proliferate the shoots, root, either in vitro or ex vitro, as we have discussed in and its benefits yesterday itself, field transfer of the plants or in the farmer's field. Yes, I think I think recently one book has been published on this by Anish sir, metatopolin, use of metatopolin in tissue culture. Recent publication is there in the form of books. Some research articles are also available on use of metatopolin in tissue culture. In our laboratory, we are using metatopolin from last 4 years. It is an aromatic type of highly active cytokinin, and it is substitute for conventional cytokinin. Mafatlal ji, Wait. Yes, sir. Screen is visible now.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay. I'm sorry. I think I have not shared my screen in the beginning. Right. Fine. No problem. Now I'm going to share it. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Right. So, just coming out from the conventional chemicals and tools and techniques which we are using in the field of plant cell and tissue culture technology we are discussing today here, right? So we are using metatopolin as an substitute or alternative to the conventional type of cytokinins. Means at the place of BA, which we are using BAP, GIATIN, even TDZ also, right? And mostly in industrial setup, people are using BA or BAP only. Right. So how we can get better type of results by use of any other type of chemical compound or cytokinin, right? So just for search of such a better type of substitute or better type of option, we tried metatopolin by going through some literature survey also. So around 4 or 5 years back, we started using metatopolin. And the results are wonderful. We can see here. I'm going to share my research experience only. What we are doing right now at present. I think it will be useful for the young generation. As such, we found that metatopolin improves adventitious shoot regeneration, even qualitative and qualitative both way. Better morphogenesis we observed. It improves chlorophyll pigments, photosynthetic pigments, so plants are better synthesize their own food while in under in vitro conditions, heterotrophic conditions itself. Because generally we see that photosynthetic pigments used to be low amount when the plants are cultured under in vitro conditions because ready-made food is available for them. It improves, it alleviates the in vitro induced disorders like micromorpho anatomical disorders, physiological and biochemical disorders. And ultimately, if these things are happening, ultimately this will improve the acclimatization process also when the plants are shifted to the ex vitro or field conditions. This is the first live example in which we used metatopolin as alternate substitute for BAP. Even we compared in our study BAP with metatopolin, BA with metatopolin, metatopolin and TDZ. Actually, the plant Scevola tacarda, it is a coastal area plant. And basically, we got in Pondicherry from Andaman Nicobar Island only. One of our friend from Oroville Botanical Garden, the French national, he brought from Andaman Nicobar Island, and only one plant, and he suggested that, he asked us actually, requested that, can you give me 50,000 plants of Scaeola artacata? It happened around four years back. Right, so we took it as a challenge because the plant is a hemistrophilus, littoral sub, coastal area only it is growing. It is regionally extinct actually, but in some ex vitro conservatory it is growing in the world. It is salt tolerant plant and cultivated for landscape to control sea erosion in the coastal area. It is also used as a bio wall. Wherever the industry people or the people who are making resorts nearby the coastal area, they are using two lines of this plant, they are growing there just to get rid from the soil erosion, sea erosion. And this plant is growing in such a way, a bushy plant, which is a bush with beautiful ornamental purpose is also there. The plant is growing in such a way that it can stop the salty wind of sea. So there is a huge demand of this plant in some of the countries. That is why that a French friend asked us to develop a protocol and give him 50,000 plants. So we have developed a protocol for this by use of metatopoline. Yeah, basically we started with the nodal shoot segments only. This is the most preferred way of regeneration of plants. The shoots were inoculated on DAP as well as metatopoline. Finally, we realized that metatopoline is a better substitute as compared to, the results are better as compared to BAP. With that one, another thing we did, at the place of solid medium, semi-solid medium, at the place of use of agar-agar, we used liquid medium when the shoots started multiplying. At multiplication stage, the cocktail what we used is metatopoline with liquid medium, and we got the wonderful results. Since huge demand was there, and the target was 50,000 plants, so cost has to be reduced. And by use of liquid medium, we reduce the cost of use of gelling agent. As yesterday we have discussed, we used agar-agar, phytogel, and finally we came to the plant gel. Even now we are trying to come avoid plant gel also. In each and every protocol we are trying liquid medium, so that gel substitute should be avoided. And liquid medium is having its own advantages also. Though as discussed, Kulia sir and I think Parth Desai also discussed that liquid medium is having chances of more contamination, that is true. But by doing or handling carefully, maintaining proper aseptic conditions, we can get far, far better results than the media that is having gelling agents. Because nutrient uptake used to be more. If phenolic leach outs are there, these can be released in the medium, dispersed here and there, not accumulated at one place in the medium. Right? Better results we can get by use of liquid medium. I suggest my young friends, at least in whatever plant system you are using, at least try one time liquid medium also. But try carefully. Maintain proper conditions, aseptic conditions, handle properly, you won't get contamination. And the shoots, another thing is, we are using ex vitro rooting technology only now. In vitro, in general, we have been avoided just to save the cost of production and just to get the better type of rooting system. Right? Just the cut end of the shoot, give auxin treatments, you have to optimize your conditions. The requirement of auxin. Give the treatment, put in either soil lite, perlite, whatever the soil mixture you are using or manure mixture you are using, put in that under greenhouse conditions within 2 to 3 weeks or maybe 4 weeks. you will get the results. You will get good rooting system. That will be better than the in vitro root. We tried in this plant and we got 100% success. Better root system is there. Even in photo, in figure F, you can see the roots are coming out of the paper cups. Paper cups, again, this is an eco-friendly method. Right? Small, small paper cups. Tea paper cups are available in market for the tea purpose, drinking of tea purpose, serving of tea purpose. We are using these now. Right? In 50 rupees, we are getting more than 100 cups. Right? So cheaper at each and every stage, how we can make tissue culture technology cheap, we are trying that. So metadoporin, we got better result in this Scheola Takata. Here we compared the photosynthetic pigments, the cultures which are growing in BAP containing medium and the cultures which are growing in metadoporin media. And we got the photosigment, the total amount of photosynthetic pigments in metadoporin derived media are far, far better than the BAP derived or BAP grown shoots, leaves. We compared from the leaf part only, right? Next example is where we tried metadoporin as a better alternative as compared to other conventional cytokinins. That is in spice crop, vanilla planifolia, an orchid. And we all understand how important vanilla is, vanilla flavor. Vanilla ice creams, a big industry, huge industry is there all over the world. It is also known as international spice crop. And it's highly expensive, right? Huge demand is there in tissue culture industry also. In this, we tried metadoporin and got wonderful results. Here also we tried liquid medium. After initiation of cultures, multiple suits were shifted to the liquid medium with metadoporin. We compared with the other cytokinins also, got wonderful results. Even we have compared the anatomical changes with the BA and NA derived medium, NA derived suits and metadoporin and NA derived, because we optimized this protocol where NA was essential for better growth and development of the suits in case of vanilla planifolia. When the suits were transferred to the liquid medium with metadoporin and NA, better micromorphological features were developed. Cuticle development was there. Stomatal development was, proper stomata development was there. Xylem and phloem improved. So they got better results in ex vitro rooting also. Better health of the plants were there. You can see the figure, last figure. We have hardened the plants successfully with 100% survival success. And the results were published in PCTOC last year. Here also we compared metadoporin with BAP. The content of photosynthetic content in the leaves of metadoporin derived media and BAP derived. The next is where we tested metadoporin is Oxystelma esculentum. One Asclepiodaceae member, unexplored, so we tried that. So here you can see initiation we did on agar gel medium. Basically it is agar, it's old. Next we transferred these to the gel only. That is a plant gel, you can see almost transparent. As yesterday we have discussed, same gel is there. First figure is with the agar, second and third is with the plant gel only, fully transparent. And got the results on BA and metadoporin. You can see the difference here. Contrast results are there. And you will be surprised to know that this happened in last lockdown. Unable to come to the institute. So when we entered after lockdown, Oxystelma cultures were like this with the metadoporin. You can see the results here. Unbelievable. The suits are coming out of the culture flask from side of the cotton plex. So I request all my young friends, just try one time at least metadoporin and see the results. One time you must try. Then at micro level, micromorph level also, metatoculin proved better, right? Stomata, stomatal aperture, opening of the stomata, size of the stomata, trichomes, number of trichomes, trichome density, stomatal density, vein islets, vein terminations, all improved with the healthy plants, healthy leaves, and more healthy leaf area. Even anatomical observations were also done comparatively with the BA and metatopolium. And you can clearly see the differences here. How the photosynthetic pigments were synthesized, the quantity, visible difference is there. No need to go for any type of even phytochemical analysis also. Pellicle tissue layers you can see here. Cuticle formation is started here under in vitro conditions itself. Better type of metaxylem and protoxylem elements are there. Phloem, vascular bundles improved. So if we are getting this type of improvements in the micromorphology of the plants under in vitro conditions, then the survival chances, better rooting and survival chances of these such type of plantlets are there in the greenhouse and in the field also. So ultimate target of our tissue culture is, technique is, how each and every plant, each and every shoot which we are making inside the laboratory should survive under the field conditions. That is the only target, without any kind of loss. Then only we can connect research with the society, research with the industry, and ultimately tissue culture is industry now. We are reaching till the farming community, right? So the research which is reaching till farmers, that kind of research is needed. The next example is Dioscorea pentaphylla. Recently we worked on this. Here also we have tested our metatopolin and we did the comparative study with the TDZ this time. It is found better than even TDZ also, because on BAP that much better results we were unable to get in this case. So we tried TDZ and then metatopolin and got wonderful results. Even tuber formation, it is a tuber crop, underutilized tuber crop. So good tuber formation was also there. I'll show you in next few slides. So this can be tried in tuberous crops also. And around 98% survival success we have observed in the greenhouse conditions. We did the genetic fidelity analysis that whether due to metatopolin, any kind of genetic variation is there or not. So with the help of our friend from Kakatiya University, Warangal, Dr. Panikant is there, and his team, Professor Alini A.V. Rao, sir, Professor Abagani, sir, with the help of them, we did genetic fidelity analysis also. It's a part of teamwork. And we found that genetic variability is not at all there. It means we can use as a better substitute of BAP. Metatopolin can be used. Apart from that, we tried to find out what are the other biochemical changes that are taking place because of metatopolin in the cultures. And then we observed that total soluble sugar, reducing sugar, photosynthetic pigments, all improved, which are vital for the better growth and development of the plantlets under in vitro, ex vitro, and in vivo conditions. And that is why finally the plants are surviving better in the greenhouse conditions and in vivo conditions. The next story about the aloe vera, as we all know about that. And the good thing is, lot of work is there. More than 200 different types of research articles are available on aloe vera, right? But how metatopolin can enhance? We tested aloe vera with BAP, TDZ, and metatopolin. And we found that metatopolin is far, far better than all these two alternatives. We tried even liquid medium also here. And amazing results we got. The initiation, multiplication, multiplied on metatopolin, BAP, TDZ we used. Wonderful rhizogenesis we got while multiplication itself started. Even we never tried in vitro and ex vitro rooting also, because roots were already started while the cultures were at the final stage. So directly these shoots with the little bit of root we shifted to the hardening facility. Plants were hardened, shifted to the nursery and to the field also. Here also, we try to find out what are the micromorphological changes taking place in succulents. In succulents, you can clearly, it is visible, you can see here. Right? First and second is, first is with the TDZ abnormality, we can see here. Cuticle start, just big, very thin cuticle is there. But when we shifted the cultures to metatopolium, see the location of stomata here in figure E. Stomata came down with the epidermis cells. Cuticle, thick cuticle synthesis started. Stomata almost normalized. No abnormality was observed. The pore size is also reduced. And such type of parameters used to help in a better type, better rooting and better hardening. Acclimatization process. The biochemical analysis also we did. Even we measured the thickness also. What are the differences in photosensitive pigments? Thickness of the lamina, stomatal density, stomatal abnormality, rate of transpiration we have measured. Because these used to ultimately decide how plant will respond under ex vitro and in vivo conditions. Then friends, with the somatic emergence, I think from yesterday, each and every speaker spoke about the somatic emergence, right? So it's very common now, but still somatic emergence is important. In each and every plant we need, the protocol should be developed to have somatic emergence, either direct or indirect type of somatic emergence. It's a need of the time. So we need protocols. But one thing what we observed is, if you have somatic emergences in any type of any plant, either it is a herb, shrub or tree, and you want to publish your work, most of the standard journal, they won't publish your work, right? They want something extra with that. What I suggest for the young minds, go for anatomical evidence also. Then your chances are there that you will get the paper published. This is not just for paper publication. Somatic embryogenesis we can use for large scale production of plant layers. This was the work we did in Hebanthus inispermus. Actually the plant is having aphrodisiac property. So in South India, most of the people, especially Ayurvedic Vedyas and all, they have harvested it like anything in the name of aphrodisiac properties, right? So it is our duty to develop a suitable protocol for the plant. So we did this work and we got good somatic evidences in that. With the anatomical evidences we have published in 2016 itself, that yes, these are the different stages we can see of somatic embryogenesis. Even we did the biochemical analysis also, that what are the biochemical changes taking place, right, during somatic embryogenesis. That, and we have published this article long ago. Yeah. This is the next story of related to Scaevola Takada. As we have earlier discussed, we regenerated from the shoot itself, nodal shoot segment. We regenerated and we developed a protocol. We were surprised to know that each and every cell of the leaf of Scaevola Takada have the capacity to regenerate to directly or direct can regenerate and directly it can produce somatic embryos. From the leaf surface itself. Just inoculate leaf on proper medium. Within 2 weeks, you will see the bulging everywhere, dot like structures will be there. Entire leaf used to covered with the somatic embryos. Somatic embryos, all the stages you can observe it in one section itself. And you can see how the vascular bundles are reaching to the somatic embryos to supply nutrients and to supply water. And these somatic embryos were germinated, multiplied, rooted, and the plantlets were hardened in the greenhouse and sent to the Oroville Botanical Garden. And the work was published in South African Journal of Botany in last year itself, during Corona time period. Yeah, the next recent I can't say it's recent trends, but it is, yes. Synthetic seeds with cold storage. Since we don't have in our institute cryopreservation facility, so whatever the facility available with us, that is deep freezer or refrigerators we have. So synthetic seeds with cold storage, and then do the normal thawing process and go for regeneration again. If you can do that much, it is having a huge impact, huge importance is there. As we know that synthetic seeds technology is having its own importance, right? It's easy to store. For longer time duration, we can store the synthetic seeds. Easily transported to any part of the country, any part of the world. We can maintain the elite type of material for longer time duration. So with this, we worked on Vanda tessellata. We got very good somatic amelogenesis in that. Anatomically confirmed that yes, somatic amelogenesis is there. Chemically analyzed that yes, changes are taking place with each and every stage. The somatic embryos were encapsulated by use of sodium alginate and calcium chloride solutions, and it is a standard procedure is there. We did it. And the somatic embryos, these are also known as artificial seeds. These are also now, after encapsulation, we call these synthetic seeds, artificial seeds, stored in refrigerator at 4 degrees centigrade for 12 months. And then by doing proper thawing process, we again put in the medium and we got very good response from that. Seeds, synthetic seeds were germinated, somatic embryo responded, suits were multiplied, hardened, and growing on the stems of, since it is epiphyte in our institute, stems of the trees of the institute. And the results we published in ECTOC last year itself. Another example of somatic embryogenesis, synthetic seed technology, and anatomical evidence is another orchid again, Spathoglottis plicata. Beautiful pink color orchid, pink colored flowered orchid. We developed directly from the leaf, we got synthetic seed, somatic embryos. These embryos were germinated, proliferated, anatomically evidences were collected, and we synthesized artificial seeds encapsulated with the gel, stored at -4 degrees centigrade. For 60 days, 2 months, again taken back and germinated on the medium, multiplied the suits. Even liquid medium we used here also. Good rooting was there. Plantlets were hardened and field transferred. This is another story. This is a terrestrial type of orchid growing in the soil only. Yeah. This is Crinum malabaricum. As yesterday, a little bit we have discussed about that. Actually, this plant was discovered in 2013, I think, yeah, by Professor Lekhak and Professor Yadav of Kolhapur University, Shivaji University, Kolhapur, in 2013, I think. They published this work in Cube Latin in 2015, I think, if I am right, I remember correctly. And we have gone through this article in 2016 and to the SERP DST. Because why we were that much interested in that? Because Professor Yadav and Lekhak reported that only around 1,000 plants are only available in Western Ghats. And this is endemic to the Western Ghats. Critically endangered plant as per IUCN. So it was a bound duty. I was part of Western Ghat that time. I was working there. It was bound duty as a tissue culturist, it was bound duty of mine to propagate this plant. So we simply approached for fund from the SERP and SERP sanctioned immediately. We worked on this plant, still we are working on this plant. Now with one of my friend in a lovely professional university, Dr. Vijay Kumar, right, collaboratively we are working on this plant. We have developed a wonderful protocol for this plant by use of twin scale and tri-scale method. And now we are in a position to supply even within 1 year, we can make more than 1 lakh plants. That much optimization of protocol we have done, or different methods we have used. So especially in yesterday's discussion, we have discussed about the direct regeneration. Here we are discussing about the somatic embryogenesis and synthetic seeds in this plant also by use of tri-scale technique. Because the scales are important here because it's a bulbous plant. So in between the scales, there is a meristematic region that we can activate, stimulate by use of hormones, by use of certain type of plant growth, especially the cytokinins. Metatopolin also has been used here. You can see very wonderful, wonderful, beautiful structures. You can see here somatic embryos, right? The somatic embryos, even anatomical evidence is also collected. Somatic embryos were used for synthetic seed production. These were cold stored. And again, plantlets were retrieved. And we got very good shoot multiplication after retrieval from the somatic embryo and cold storage. Plantlets were hardened. And transplanted back to the natural habitats from where we have collected few plants. In Kerala, that is one nearby Kasaragod district, Central University of Kerala, plant was collected from there. Yes, friends. The next is one cacti species. One cactus species, we worked on that, on the same aspect. It is Ferrocactus peninsulae. The cacti is basically available in growing in Mexican desert. Beautiful cactus. We got from Oroville Botanical Garden from my friend, friend's friend only. He brought it from Mexico. And we got some seeds of this cactus. And again, same demand was there. Can you make this much of thousands of plants of this cactus? Because they wanted many plants, many cacti. We took it as a challenge. Commonly, it is known as barrel cactus. The seeds are resistant to saline stress also. Growth is very slow. And same way, reproductive period also. It is self-incompatibility is also there. Very low seed production. So automatically, as tissue culturists, it is our duty to work on such type of plants where the plants are not at all available. We have to multiply this. So from our friend, we got a few seeds. Seeds we germinated. And we tried whether seeds germinated, in vitro germinated seeds can be converted into synthetic seeds. Seedlings, in vitro germinated seedlings. So we encapsulated seedlings and stored also under low temperature. And tested that after storage at -4°C for 1 year, whether we can germinate these or not. We tried in vitro and we got almost 100% success in the in vitro germination of synthetic seeds, which were stored at -4°C. All the seeds were germinated and shoots were multiplied, rooted, hardened, and the hardened plants were given to the botanical garden. Another aspect is whether these synthetic seeds can be directly grown or directly can be germinated into the soil or the soilite or the vermicompost or the vermiculite, perculite, whatever the soil mixture you have. In that, whether the synthetic seeds which we made of this soil, whether we can make direct germination in the soil or not. We tried that in soil, right? And almost 100% germination we have achieved in that. Right? In that case, what we observed that these synthetic seeds can be transferred to the any part of the world. This is the practical example. They can simply put these synthetic seeds into the soil. These will germinate and give the plants. Hardened plants. Now these are ready to field transfer. Right. So after that, we try to find out, because this is a xeropetic plant, what is the adaptational or acclimatization strategy or mechanism of xeropetic plant, how these are used to adapt, acclimatized, because these are growing in extreme conditions. And we are growing these plants in the extreme sophisticated conditions, under in vitro conditions. So what is the mechanism of adaptation of this type of cacti plants, right? So we have gone through the anatomical studies, and we came to know that the parameters which are essentially improved in other plants, here also equally working here. So under in vitro conditions, as we have seen in other plants, underdeveloped cuticle and epidermis is there. But when these are coming to the greenhouse conditions, these are again developing thick cuticle, thicker than other normal plants. Vascular bundles were underdeveloped under in vitro conditions, but very well developed in vitro, very well developed vascular tissue, vascular bundles we can see under the in vivo or in vitro conditions. Another aspect that was full of surprise for us, the development of spines. Based on the development, number of spines, length of the spine, development of the spine, even appendages on the surface of the spines, we can predict the developmental stage in hardening of the cacti. If the development of spines are too good, reaching at perfect stage, number of spines are reaching at the perfect optimized stage, then your plant is ready for ex vitro transfer, field transfer, right? That is the wonderful thing we observed in this plant. Spines are having a role in the adaptational mechanism of cactus. We can see here under in vitro and ex vitro conditions. In the last two slides, you can observe that, two photographs. Appendages on the surface of the spines, number of spines per areoli, and how the appendages which are there on the surface of the spines. These used to determine that, yes, by counting of these, we can predict that, yes, the plant is ready for the survival or not ready for the survival, not ready to field transfer. Yeah. The next current aspect, or recent aspect, which we are working on, that is tuberization, in vitro tuber formation, induction of tubers under controlled conditions in the tuberous crops. And the example is here. We induced tubers in Cryodem marabarico because it is tuberous plant. And if the tuber is available with the plant will get 100% survival success. If your in vitro plant is having one small tuber with that, it means stored food is there with the plant. It shows 100% survival success of your plant in the ex vitro, under ex vitro and in vivo conditions. Right? This is the guarantee of in vitro regenerated tuberous. Or in other words, we can say bulbous plants, where bulb is there or tuber is there. Right? So tuber or bulbs under in vitro condition is the guarantee of survival success of the plant under ex vitro and in vivo conditions. So if we can induce bulbs or tubers under in vitro conditions, that is an added advantage of tissue culture to the bulbous and tuberous crops. Right. So for that, we tried again stress mechanism, cross stress mechanism, as we have discussed yesterday. Right. By use of incubator sector, we gave stress treatment to the cultures which are under multiplication stage. By getting that stress, tuber formation is started just for 10 minutes per day, around 100 RPM. Give every day for 2 to 4 weeks, tuber formation starts because of this mild type of stress. We tried tuberization in Dioscorea pentaphylla also, because this is a tuber is there. In Cryodem malabaricum, bulbs we have synthesized, we have induced. Here we have induced tuber because it's a tuberous crop. By use of seismic stress here also, we tried. The protocol may vary from one plant to another plant. The RPM may vary from one plant to another plant, right? And time duration also may vary. But by giving this type of stress, seismic stress, we can induce tubers. And when your shoot is having tuber or the bulb, this will survive under ex vitro conditions, under in vivo conditions. So if somebody is working on bulbous or tuberous crops, try to use stress mechanism, cross stress mechanism during when, before you are transferring your plant for rooting or hardening purpose, apply stress there itself and then make the tubers small, even small tuber is sufficient. And then transfer your plant to the hardening facility. It will give 100% survival success. This is my own observation here. Yeah. The another current aspect I can say is the application of polyethylene glycol just to induce drought kind of stress. Why we are giving more stress on stress only? Because ultimately our target is that each and every shoot under in vitro conditions should survive under the stressful conditions. What my opinion is, if we can give a mild type of stress under the in vitro conditions before transferring our plants to the ex vitro and in vivo conditions, that stress will work and make the plants a little bit hardened, acclimatized under in vitro conditions itself, so that we can get a better hardening, better kind of root system, better kind of shoot system and the foliage system under the ex vitro conditions, and the plant will survive better there, right? So along with the physical stress, for example, seismic stress we have tried, some chemical stress also can be tried, and we tried in some plants. So polyethylene glycol, as we all know that it is an inert type of osmotic agent. It used to create reduced availability of water to the cultures, because it reduced water potential of the medium. So, and it is mimicking just like stress, drought stress conditions inside the culture bottle or inside the culture vessel, right? And this is giving wonderful results. When the plant is having this type of stress that water is not available, it starts synthesizing cuticle, epicuticle are wax, proper development of epidermis, proper movement of stomata, right? Otherwise, stomata used to be always open under in vitro conditions, right? Stomatal movement starts, because when water is not available, the stomata has to close, right? So stomatal movement used to start. It means functional stomata development starts just to stop transpiration. So plant used to adapt towards that artificially created drought conditions by use of PEG. So by use of PEG, we can get better type of organogenesis and rhizogenesis, enhance biomass, so better survival we can expect. It alleviate and improve the photosynthetic pigments, carbohydrates and amino acids, especially in the foliar apparatus. What we have to do for that? Just induce the cultures, just induce the shoots on your optimized medium, multiply shoots. What we did, I am sharing with you, proliferate the shoots, get better type of rooting, or get the roots also. If you want to give stress at the multiplication stage or at rooting stage, depends on the plant system. Then for the next, before transferring, in the last subculture, add polyethylene glycol in the medium. Either it is rooting, then root medium, or proliferation, then proliferation stage, then proliferating optimized media or plant growth regulators you are using. Use that only. Addition is just add polyethylene glycol in there and see the improvements, right? It will improve morphology. It will improve anatomy. It will improve histochemicals which are present, and you can analyze these. Almost I'm going to conclude. Before that, Professor Puliyasar is still here. With due respect to sirs, and with the permission from the sir, I want to show. This is sir. This is that cultures of Polyus forescoli, sir.
Yes, good, good, good.
We are recently one research scholar is working with me from Osmania University. Good. Mr. Mahesh is there here with me.
Good.
He is working right now on this. He brought this plant from Hyderabad and he told sir, I want to work on that for training. He is here.
Right.
So we are working on Polyus forescoli.
That is good.
Right. And the beauty is here, sir.
Yeah.
From the leaf surface directly, we are getting regeneration.
Oh.
Yeah.
Very good.
From the even from 1 inch leaf, one by one, 1 inch leaf, we are getting more than 50 shoots.
Oh, very nice.
So though it is just in beginning stage only.
Yeah.
Oh, hopefully, I'll contact you.
You have not yet published it.
No, not at all, sir. This is just beginning only.
Okay, but that's good. We wish you all the best.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you. I think soon we will be in a wonderful position. And after that, I'll contact you, sir, for commercialization of this plant, sir. Right. So before concluding, one message to my young buddies. Tissue culture is essential for whatever the type of experiment you are doing in genetic engineering, molecular biology, related to plants, plant biotechnology. Tissue culture is the base of all these types of genetic improvement, somatic improvement in plants. Right. The genetic engineers, they can transfer the gene to single cells only. One or two cells, they can make genetic modifications, whatever the method they are using, whatever the method we are using. Few cells, they can make genetically modified cells. Ultimately, cells have to come to the cell and tissue cultist only. They can regenerate, they can make cell into callus, and they are the only people who can develop plants from the callus cells. So ultimately, friends, we are here to regenerate the plants. So we need a reliable protocol, regenerative protocol for each and every plant species which are available with us. That is the requirement of today's. Don't think I want to work on this plant only. No. We need to develop a regenerative protocol for each and every plant. Today we don't know the usefulness of that protocol. Tomorrow it will be highly useful. So try to develop a regenerative protocol, a wonderful protocol. Try to optimize the conditions, in vitro, ex vitro, in vivo conditions for each and every plant. Right? We are always useful and we will be always useful for the benefit of, for the improvement of plant biotechnology. Most welcome for any type of query, any type of question. Thank you very much, sir. Especially, special mention to Pulia, sir. You were there.
Congratulations. It is a masterly lecture. I guess.
Sir, your blessing, sir. I am blessed.
It's a masterly lecture. We wish you many more successes. Work hard.
Sure. Yeah. Sure, sir. We'll, sir. Sure, sir.
Dr. Shekhawat, hello.
Yes. Dr. Shekhawat, Dr. Paramik Bhattacharya would like to interact with you.
Yeah. Sir, good morning. Sir.
How are you?
Very fine. Very fine. Thank you very much. How do you do, sir?
Metadobulin holds a special place in my heart, you know very well. Because when people never knew, we started that work.
from
the lab, basically, which invented metadobulin. Uh-huh. I would just like to, because recently I am doing a work with, as you had seen, orchids and medicinal herbs. You had shown in a slide that in lockdown, the plants are coming out of the flask due to less, you can't get the chance of doing the subculturing. The same incident happened, and I just out of my query, I started an experiment. We just did the you can see there will be definitely some leaves, semi-dead and dead leaves, which get accumulated because of wilting. This, we did the auxin and cytokine in profiling, and we have found that these substratum acts as a conducive medium from which the plants are growing up where there is no availability of the media or when the media gets depleted. Did you see any change in the, did you do any such work? Because this is an interesting angle, and we have found that the if you do the auxin or cytokine in profiling, the in, there is a content which can act as a, it can act as a stopgap measure in case of this type of emergency situations, like we did in case of Nehu also. Dr. Professor Kumaria is also doing, and in Professor Van Staden yes. also we started in with the impact of the LEDs. We yes, did sir. It in RCBGD South Africa, and even in CSIR we are also trying the same. So did you do anything of that sort?
No, sir. Actually, what happened when we came?
Because what I, why I'm saying is because I saw that photograph of that plant coming out directly of the flask, and this is a clear case that there's some sort of like it is developing, development stages are growing, and nutrient availability is there, what I feel. So yes. what can be the source?
Yeah, it's really interesting to know that, right? But unfortunately, we were unable to do that because middle of the lockdown, we got the chance to come and see. Meantime, they told, okay, go again, lockdown started. So we lost the cultures actually last year itself. Right.
Secondly, I would like also...
It's a really, really, really good idea. Again, we'll try some of this.
Secondly, I would also like to ask, did you have shown the impact of impactization of this stress, basically that movement, shaker movement, what you are calling
yes.
seismic and all this agitation, whatever. Me, did you do, because the impression I have from you, this shaker, there is no light illumination. Did you give a combinatorial impact of light, like LEDs are playing a very triggering role, LEDs and this stress as a conducive, as a amalgamation of these two can act as a boon? Because recently Vijay published in Somatic on, if you go through these reviews in AP on this Actinophysiologia plantarum, LEDs are one of the most triggering agents which play, as for my knowledge, I have a very limited knowledge of plant tissue culture, but this particularly in case of orchids, it does have an impact. So it will be an area which I feel if you can work upon. And thirdly, you have shown the genetic fidelity with ISS. And now, actually, the present trend, what I can see while reviewing also, many people say, whoa, ISS is a dominant marker. It is not. So, the, many of them ask about the genome size and the like this flow cytometrical analysis.
Yes. Yes.
Do you
sir,
do
yes.
anything of that sort?
No, sir. Till now, flow cytometry, we never tried.
Because it would have been a very... Because in case of metadopoli, why I am saying, as I belong to the fraternity of Carol Dolezal and Miroslav Strand and Van Staden, we will be very happy to see that how this magical hormone, because truly metadopoli, I am very grateful to you, because very few people in India, and before our group in Nehu started, that know about, yes. knows about this metadopoli. It's a magical hormone.
Yes,
particularly, it's derivatives.
Suman Kumaria, madam, and all. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, derivatives, particularly ribosides, the Professor Tandon also. These yes. hormones actually, hormone actually has a magical power, and I am yes. very much thankful. It's a very informative piece of work. Just if you can validate these steps, and I am also, I will be interested to join that team, because it will be a great thing. Please, and sir, lastly, please. I would like to acknowledge it's a welcome. Very, very, very informative piece of work. And without tissue culture, how much we say CRISPR, how much we say transgenic, we can't survive. Simply,
exactly, sir.
It's a very good thing. Thank you. Thank you. It's a great piece of work.
Thank okay. you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for.
I should call you, sir. I am my junior.
This is.
I am junior to you,
sir. Here, it's not junior and senior, sir. Your ideas are wonderful, sir. Right? I got three ideas. Right? LED impact of LED with the stress. We have to try. Plus the cultures which are coming out, suits which are coming out from the culture tubes. Profiling I'll do, sir. Right?
Yes.
And. The third point also I'll take care of that.
It's a treasure trove. Basically, metadopoli is a treasure trove. It's a magical hormone.
Yes.
Particularly the stability part, what we have found that it adducts that are being produced in case of this. I have written in my papers also, and you have also written, the adjuncts that are being produced in case of BAP and kinetin or any other, even TDZ also, the abnormalities are the main reason for that things, which in case of metadopoli is not produced. And even if it is produced, it gets localization rate is very less and it gets immobilized. That's the main thing.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Nice.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks. Thanks a lot, sir.
Any
other queries, sir? Yes, Mohammad Lalji.
Good afternoon, sir, for a very wonderful session. There are several questions we have in chat box. So you can answer.
Okay, chat box. Okay. Yes. Question answers. Let me see here.
And I would like to summarize because we are running short of time. We have next speaker. So I would like to summarize this session. Yes, it is a wonder cytokine in metatopoly. And Professor Van Staden Lab is working on metatopoly. I think Paromik sir has worked on
that. Paromik sir, then Bhattacharya sir is there.
Yes, Bhattacharya sir.
Paromik Bhattacharya sir, then Amita madam, Amita Bhattacharya.
Yes, Amita madam.
I would like to thank this occasion.
Suman Kumaria.
Yeah. They are the stalwart sir. We followed them only sir.
I have received one message from Pramod Kumar sir for the grand success of this event. He is running short of time, so he has sent his blessings. So thank you, Paromik sir. And Professor Shekhawat has shared beneficial impact of metatopoline with several case studies. And he has highlighted importance of metatopoline on several plants like Stevia Takada, Oxysterma esculenta, Diosporia, aloe vera, vanilla, international spice. He has also discussed how in vitro degradation will occur, and he has also highlighted importance of uses of pepper crop. So you can reduce the cost of micropropagated plant. And for the acclimatization of micropropagated plant, it is important to study various parameters. So he has discussed several parameters like micromorphological, anatomical, histological, biochemical parameters. So yes, indeed, these factors play a significant role in micropropagation and acclimatization. So it is a good area to explore, because until and unless your plants are survive in the field condition, it is complete failure of tissue culture. So I congratulate Professor Shekhawat that he did excellent job. And he did research on several plants, and he has transferred all those micropropagated plants to field condition. I am associated with Professor Shekhawat sir since several years, and I have learned many things from him. So thank you very much for being part of this conference, and he has accepted the second lecture.
Thank you, sir.
Within 10 hours. And this PPT is prepared within, I think, 2 or 3 hours.
So it's sir, always ready, sir. Always ready, sir.
Only people like you can do.
It is our work. Our work. So since we are doing, and it's our work, anytime ready to say, sir.
Yeah. So thank you very much, sir. And I also welcome Professor Pulaya, sir, Abhihai, sir, Professor Kirtan Dave, Sumita, madam, Chakrabarti, sir. Good afternoon, Chakrabarti sir. Good afternoon, Ghanshyam sir. Good afternoon, Professor Ashwini Kumar sir. So, thank you everyone for being part of this conference. Now, I request Dr. Akhilesh Prajapati to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Nitish Kumar.
So thank you, sir, for a wonderful talk. Our next speaker in line of the session, Dr. Nitish Kumar. Welcome, sir. Dr. Kumar is a senior assistant professor, Department of Biotechnology at Central University of Bihar. He obtained his master's degree in agri-biotech from CSK Himachal Pradesh Agriculture University, Palanpur, and PhD in botany from CSIR CMCRI Bhavnagar University. His area of specialization in plant tissue culture, genetic transformation of plants, molecular marker development, mutation breeding, and microbial biotechnology. He is a principal investigator of various research projects from funding agencies like UGC, DST, DAE, etc., worth rupees more than 50 lakhs. Dr. Kumar is a recipient of various awards and fellowships during his research career, which includes Fast Track Young Scientist Award from DST and all CSIR, ICR, DBT, NED, JRFships, etc. He has published more than 60 publications in his repute, which includes peer review of publications, various book chapters, and books. He has also filed 2 Indian patents. Dr. Kumar is a reviewer of various prestigious journals, which include Planta, PLOS, PLOS One, Gene, Molecular Biology Reports, Journal of Plant Biochemistry and Biotechnology. Dr. Kumar will deliver today a talk on application of plant tissue culture and transgenic technology in crop improvement. I welcome Dr. Nishit Kumar in the webinar, and I'm inviting you for your deliberation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for the kind introducing me. And also I am thankful to you people for inviting me for this conference. By the Dr. Mufat Lal invited contact me 4 days back. So thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my research work with you people. So I am audible now?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So at present, I'm working on the different aspect of the tissue culture. But previously, I did work on the different, in my career, of the scientific career, I did work on the different plant for the development of the regeneration protocol. So I would like to share my screen now. Is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Oh. Now the topic for the today's discussion is the application of the plant tissue culture and transgenic technology in the crop improvement. In earlier lecture, I was listening Dr. Sakhawat sir discussing for any technology for the development of transgenic plant or any genetic engineering or genetic manipulation. Tissue culture is the prerequisite. Regeneration is the prerequisite. I am 100% agree with this sentence. Because without getting the wonderful protocol, we cannot produce the transgenic plant. So one by one, I will discuss the points. So first of all, I like to discuss about the tissue culture. The simple definition of the tissue culture is the growing of plant cell or tissue or organ or any parts of the plant in a sterile environment on an artificial nutrient medium for the generation of the plants. So our objective is to generate the millions of plants from the single cell. In nature gives the single seed to generate the single plant, but our objective is to generate the millions of plants from the single cell, single tissue or single organ. And this is only possible by the plant tissue culture. There is no other technique available which can produce millions of plants from the single cell. Nature gives the seeds, one seed, one plant in general. So this is the beauty of the plant tissue culture. We can generate the millions of plants from the single cell, single tissue or organ or any parts of the plant. So when I discuss with the MSc student, I generally ask what are the different importance of the plant tissue culture in respect to the crop improvement. The first beauty or first importance, or we can say the plus point of plant tissue culture, is the generation of the millions of plant. Already I've discussed this thing from the single cell tissue organ. At the same time, we can generate the uniform plant or true two type plants by the tissue culture. There may be chance of some somatoform variation, I agree, but there is more chance to get the uniform plant, that means similar to the mother plant. So this is one of the beauty of the plant tissue culture. At the same time, by the tissue culture, we can generate number of plants irrespective of season. We are not dependent on the seasons. In tissue culture, we can generate the plants irrespective of the season. At the same time, we can generate the disease-free plant. And also another importance is that we can generate the sex-specific plant. I did a small work on the date palm. Particularly, this is applicable for the dioecious plant because fruit arise only in the female plant. So, for example, if date palm fruiting comes after the 8 to 10 years, farmers can know that this was in general nature gives the 50% male, 50% female by the seed. But by the tissue culture, we can select that plant from the female tissue. That plant will be the female. Or in general, in that case, for the one male plant is sufficient for the 100 female plant for the pollination. So we can generate the sex specific plant by the tissue culture in case of the dioecious plant. And yes, for the development of the transgenics, regeneration protocol is the prerequisite. So these are the some importance of the plant tissue culture. The logic behind is the regeneration. Already so many people have already discussed about the totipotency. It is the ability of cell or tissue or organ to grow, develop into the fully differentiated plants. Without totipotency, totipotency is the hidden power of the cell which can grow into the plants. If totipotency, if explant lost the totipotency, that plant cannot grow into the plants. So age is the, sometimes we discuss about the age. Age is the one of the important factor during the selection of the explants. The logic behind is a totipotency. The plant parts which are highly totipotent, they have more and more chance to get more number of plants from that particular explants. Now, these are the some basic methodology of the plant tissue culture. I think there is no need to discuss, but for the MSc student, we can discuss this thing. The step or the preparation of the suitable nutrient medium. This is the important parameter, one of the important parameters in plant tissue culture, particularly the selection of the plant growth regulators. During the nutrient mediums, the plant growth regulator play the important role in the plant tissue culture. Now the selection of explant, depends on the health of the plant and also the totipotency ability of the plants, of the plant parts. Now the third step is the sterilization of the explants before doing the tissue culture inside the lab. We should sterilize the explant by using the different concentration and combination of the sodium hypochlorite, mercury chloride, and we can use the fungicide or we can use the antibiotics like the streptomycin. Now, another step is the inoculation. That is means we transfer the explant on the culture medium that we have prepared, and the incubation, the culture medium incubated in the culture condition having the 25+1 degree temperature with the relative humidity of up to the 50% to 70% of the light period, 16 hours of the photo periods. Then the another step is the subculture after getting the elongation of the explant, which is transfer after the 2 week of the intervals. Then after getting the plants, we can harden it and finally transfer to the plant. Our objective is to transfer the tissue culture plant in the field. They should survive in the field. If they will not survive, the protocol is the useless. So finally, we have to transfer the tissue culture plant into the field. So these are the basic steps which is commonly used in the plant tissue culture. And this is a summary of the whole the tissue culture technique. This slide shows the summary of the plant tissue culture technique. This is the plants. These are the soot tips. By the soot tip, we can make the virus-free plant or disease-free plant. And by this explant, by the leaf, we can use for the direct organogenesis or by the indirect organogenesis, we can generate the plant. This technology, this pathway we can use for the development of the transgenic plant. For the development of the transgenic plant, regeneration protocol is the prerequisite. So this is the whole process. This slide represents the whole steps of the process of the plant tissue culture. So during my career, I did work on the different plants. For example, I did work on the Jatropha carcass. This work I started in the 2008, 2005, approximately, and published in the 2010. First time I developed the product, that time there was very less protocol available for the Jatropha carcass, which is the most important crop plant for the biodiesel production. So I used the cotyledon relief X plants. I got the wonderful results. I will show the photographs. I got the wonderful, our team got the wonderful protocol from the cotyledon relief X plant. That is the first leaf after the seedling. We have used this explant as explant and put on the different culture, different medium composition. I use the different concentration of the growth regulators, like the PTZ, DAP, kinetin, but I got good result on the TDZ. At the concentration of the 2.27 micromolar of the TDZ, I got up to 80% efficiency, either in the inside the in vitro leaf or in vivo leaf, in case of the Jatropha carcass. But the efficiency at the BAP or kinetin, it was very, very less as compared to TDZ. I also checked the different genotypes of the Jatropha carcass, because genotype is also one of the important factors in plant tissue culture. So I used the different locations. These are the JC1, JC2, and JC3 are the genotype from the different location of India. First one is the Tamil Nadu. Second one is the Sabarmati, Gujarat. Third one is from the Rajasthan. These are the different location from where we have collected the germplasm and apply for the tissue culture. And I got the wonderful result on the 2.27 micromolar of the TDZ concentration. And this slide represents the efficiency of the soot butt induction. How much percent of the explant response for the production of the soot butts. And second slide represents the how much number of the buds present on the leaf. So I got the wonderful result on the same concentration up to the 20-25 number of buds arises on the leaf explants, either in vitro condition or in vivo condition. Of course, the efficiency of the in vitro is more as compared to in vivo, but there is no much more differences that I observed during this research work. After getting the regeneration protocol, regeneration, a soot butt induction, what I observed at high concentration of the TDZ, the regenerated soot butt are highly compact. Even the highest efficiency was observed on the, you can see here, 90% efficiency observed. But the buds which are present on the high concentration of the TDZ, they are too much compact. After some time, they become yellow. We are unable to proliferate them further. So, but the buds which arise at the 2.27 micromolar of the TDZ, that buds is easily proliferated further. So, I use this concentration for my further work. 2.27, I standardize the protocol. 2.27 micromolar of the TDZ concentration is ideal for the regeneration in the case of the Jatropha carcass. The further our objective to elongate them. After getting the buds, our objective to elongate the each and individual buds. So I tried the different combination of the growth regulators of the either the, with the cytokinins. I use the BAP, I use the IA, NA, and IBA. But I got the wonderful result on the combination of the BAP and IA. At the concentration of 2.25 micromolar of the BAP and 8.5 micromolar of the IA, I got the good elongation. NA and BAP combination, it formed a lot of callus at the base. And in the combination of BAP and IBA, it it arises more number of branches from the base. But our objective to elongate them first. I was not looking for the branching. So our this combination BAP and IA is the was the best combination for the elongation that I observed personally. After getting the elongation, our objective to get the root, because rooting was also one of the major problem in one of the important parameter in tissue culture. So we used the different combination of the auxins for getting the roots. So at the concentration of the 15 micromolar of the IBA, 5.7 micromolar of the IA, and 5.5 micromolar of the NA, it gives the wonderful result in case of the Jatropha carcass. Up to the 50% rooting was observed irrespective of the genotypes. After using the different concentration and combination of IA, we tested so many combination of the auxins, but good result was observed on the 50 micromolar of the IBA, 5.7 micromolar of the IA, and 5.5 micromolar of the NA combination. So this is, you can see here the figure. This is the in vitro leaf, in quaternary, diet soot bud is coming from the leaf. There is no any callus phase. Diet soot be generated the direct, we follow the protocol of the direct organogenesis. So you can see here, direct bud is coming from the in vitro leaf. Too much number of buds. There is no limit of the buds, but the hardly we can proliferate them up to the 20-25 plant from the leaf explant. After proliferating the shoot buds, this is the our elongated bud that I have discussed earlier. On the combination of DAP and IA, I got the good elongation, and further rooting was observed. After getting the root, we transfer in the pots, and finally, this is the one of the sample. I will show some more photographs in my later slide, and this is the one of the in the field condition. So this is the complete protocol of the regeneration protocol in case of the Jatropha carcass, which was published in the Acta Physiologia Plantarum in 2010. Another work. We did work on the non-toxic Jatropha carcass. Earlier, we did work on the Indian cultivar. Indian germplasm is in toxic in nature of the Jatropha carcass. But another variety, which is mainly found in Mexico, we call it Mexican variety, it is non-toxic in nature. So I tested the same protocol on the non-toxic Jatropha carcass. We got the seed from the Mexico and apply on the same protocol that I developed in the for the toxic Jatropha carcass. I also applied the same protocol apply on the non-toxic Jatropha carcass germplasm. And you can see here, I got the more or less similar result. Only the difference is the efficiency. The efficiency is less as compared to toxic Jatropha carcass in case of the non-toxic. So you can see here the this figure represents the in vitro leaf of the mature leaf. This is the in vivo leaf. This is the quaternary leaf. And this represents the elongation. And earlier I've discussed this branching start after adding the BAP and IBA combination. This figure represents the BAP and IBA for the elongation. When I use the BAP and IBA combination, the branching start from the base. If we use the NA with BAP combination, the coalescing starts at the base. But in the combination of BAP and IBA, there is no issue at all in the elongation. So this is the good for the elongation in case of this combination is good for the IA. BAP and IA combination is good for the elongation in case of the Jatropha carcass. And further same composition I used for the rooting. In case of the non-toxic Jatropha carcass also, these are the some potted pot plant or inside the field, outside the field. And her activity, all the parameters are the same. There is no any difference between the toxic and non-toxic. So this is all about the oxygen oxygen propagator, and similar same protocol I also use for the petiole. I also use the petiole explant for the regeneration. And I observed, and only change I got, we have changed, only change the orientation of the explants. We put in the horizontal condition as well as the vertical condition. But the more response was observed on the horizontal condition as compared to vertical condition. This may be due to the more surface area contact with the nutrient medium. In all the nutrient medium, we kept the same concentration of the TDZ, that is a 2.27 micromolar of the TDZ. We optimized this protocol, this concentration in case of the Jatropha carcass. So you can see here, this is the petiole explant. This is in the horizontal condition, and this is in the vertical condition. In both conditions, shoot buds are coming, but the number of buds is less on the vertical condition as compared to horizontal condition. Further, so, on the same medium, shoot buds are elongated, and further on the same previous protocol, concentration of the rooting we use, and we got the root, and this is our the hardened plant outside the field. And this is again another picture which potentiary petiole explants. So again, I got the more or less similar result of the previous. Only differences is the efficiency. But I got more or less the similar result on all the explants, but the leaf explants show the maximum efficiency and more number of shoot buds generated from the leaf explants in case of the Jatropha carcass. Further in my career, I also did work on the Stevia rubiduana. I did work in the Anand Agriculture University, and I was there on the as a RA. And also I checked the genetic fidelity by the RAPD marker. Although this is the dominant marker, earlier in the previous presentation discussing about the marker, but RAPD we can use for the genetic, for the stability check, because this is the easily available. And there is no need of any things. There is no need of any prerequisite information. We can just check it. So we have used the different combination of the PGR having the, we have changed the concentration of the MS medium, half salt MS medium, full salt MS medium, and different concentration of the VAP. And we got the good result on the modified MS medium having the 2 mg per liter of kinetin and 1 mg per liter of the VAP. And in all the other combination, we got the mono problem is the callus formation and also the vitrification in the explants. But in this combination, modified MS medium, which contains the 2 mg per liter of the kinetin, 1 mg per liter of the VAP, 1% sucrose in place of the 3%, and this agar concentration gives the good results. Further, I check in case of the Stevia rubiduana, different type of the culture vessels. We use the glass jars, solid medium, glass jar with the liquid medium, glass flask with liquid medium, and plastic growth container, just like the small bioreactor. And I got the wonderful result on the plastic growth container, up to the 9.56 multiplication rate was observed in case of the plant growth container. And whereas in case of the glass jar, they observed up to the 5 to 6 times multiplication rate. But in case of the plastic growth container, we got the 9 times multiplication rate in case of the Stevia rubiduana. Further, we have tested the, we have tried for the rooting medium. And in case of the Stevia, there is no problem of the rooting. But the good, but the number of roots may vary from the medium on the depends on the plant growth, different PGRs. So I go now, there is no problem in the rooting percentage, but the number of roots, more roots observed on the half MS medium, more number of roots was observed in the half MS medium, having the 0.1 mg per liter concentration of the IBA and having the 100 ppm charcoal concentration. But overall, there is no problem of the rooting in case of the stevia. So this is the photo, you can see here the picture. This is the glass jar having the solid medium. This is the flask. This is a plant growth. This is a plastic growth container. And this one is the rooting plant, in vitro plant with the root. And this is our the hardened stevia plants. Hardened tissue culture stevia plant. There is no problem. And there is no issue. This is the, this is protocol was working in the lab that time. This whole about the stevia rebellion. And further, I check the genetic fertility because there may be chance of the somatic variation. So I've checked the genetic fertility by the RFID marker. Although this is dominant marker, but we can use for the genetic fertility test either the RFID or ISSR because there is no issue of the there is no need of the prerequisite information of the genome sequence for doing the RFID. Just use the random primer, amplified them, and I got the wonderful, we can say by this picture, there is no any genetic variation was observed in the region in the micropropagator plant in case of the stevia. A lens show the first lens show the mother plant, a rest plant show the randomly selected the 15 tissue culture plant, and there is no genetic variation was observed in case of the micropropagator plant. This is the similar picture by the different primers. So this whole about the stevia. Another, I did work on the a small work I did on the date palm. I don't want on the just I checked the genetic fertility after the 37 subculture. After the 37 subculture, I checked the genetic fertility of the micro propagated date palm plant. Tomorrow, Dr. Ghanshyam Patel will discuss the protocol of the date palm, how they develop the date palm, but I did there on only on the genetic fertility, but because I spent very low time in the Anand Agriculture University, I checked the genetic fertility. Is any variation present inside the in tissue culture rich plant? So I used the two different marker, RFID and ISSR both, and there is no any differences was observed in respect to the mother plant, either by the RFID or by the ISSR. After the 37 subculture, because in producing the single plant, tissue culture date palm plant, it will take 1.5 to 2 years. So there is no issue in the regenerative plant. Further, I did work on the, our objective was the, in case of the Jatropha, our objective was to develop the transgenic plants for the salt resistance. Our objective was to develop the salt resistance transgenic plants in case of the Jatropha. So earlier I developed the regeneration protocol. That protocol we have used for the transformation. I have used the agrobacteria mediated transformation protocol. And the gene construct that why I use is the DRAVA. This was isolated from the Pokhali rice variety, which is highly salt resistant. Pokhali rice variety is highly salt resistant. We isolate the DRAVA gene, clone it, and this is a complete gene set of which is inside the present. Engineered the plasmid having the DRAVA gene, GUS gene for the marker gene. Selector, so a scribble marker, and this hygromycin is the selector marker. This gene construct we have used for the making the salt resistance transgenic plant in case of Jatropha carcass. So I use the different parameters for developing the protocol in genetic transformation protocol in Jatropha carcass. We have used the pre-culture, bacteria growth phase, infection duration, method of the wounding, co-cultivation period, pH of the co-cultivation medium and different concentration of the acetoserango. Pre-culture, we kept the leaf on the medium for the different days and observed the good result on the medium from the leaf which having the 4 days of the pre-culture. Similarly, I also studied the different growth phase of Agrobacterium because OD is one of the important parameters of the virulence. The transformation depends on the virulence power of the Agrobacterium. And we got the good result on the OD having the 0.6 of the bacterial growth phase. Further, we use the infection duration, how much we can infect the leaf excellent with the Agrobacterium culture. And wonderful result got on the after the 20 minutes of the infection period, give the good results in case of the genetic transformation in Jatropha carcass. Similarly, I also use the different winding method, glass beads, hand picking, and the non-wounding, but I got the more result on the non-wounding because after wounding in the case of the Jatropha leaf, more number of phenolics is secreted. The culture medium become brown. I think that become toxic for the Agrobacterium. So I got good result on the without wounding, we can say. Further, we studied the co-cultivation period of the Agrobacterium, the leaf explant. I got the wonderful result on the of the 4 days of the co-cultivation period. Similarly, the pH of the co-cultivation medium also responsible for the transformation efficiency, but I got the good result on the medium having the 5.7 pH. Now the acetosilingone, most commonly inducer compound. I used the different concentration of the acetoserango. I got the good result on 100 micromolar of. Acetosilingone. We use. We used the different concentration of the acetosilingone and got the good result, observed the good result on the 100 micromolar of the acetosilingone. This is the one of the best inducer compound which is available. So finally, we have summarized the protocol. Already I have discussed this thing. This is the flow diagram of the protocol in case of the Jatropha carcass infection period. 100 micromolar of acetosilingone with OD of the 0.6, co-cultivation period of 4 days of the medium 5.7, passing with the cefotaxime for removing the contaminants, then the regeneration on the 2.27 micromolar of the TDH concentration, having the 0.5 microgram per ml of the hygromycin as a selectable marker. This is the co-cultivation, this is the complete protocol of the transformation method. So this is the photographs. This is a picture represent that this is the co-cultivation. This is the in vitro tissue culture, in vitro leaf explants. And this is the explants of the co-cultivation medium having the both Agrobacterium as well as the leaf. And this represent the transformed plant growing well. This is green color and untransformed is the become the brown or going to dead. And this is the gas assay, and this is the final transgenic plant that we have developed within the regeneration protocol. This is all about the complete protocol of the Jatropha carcass. Further, we have tested the characterized the transformed plant by the PCR. This is our gas. This is the gas gene 400 base pair. This is a trap gene of the amplify 866 base pair. And this is the southern blotting represent the integration of the gene. This is all about the presentation of my presenters. If any question, please ask or please discuss, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nishit Kumar, sir, for a nice presentation. There are several questions in Q&A session. So I will be grateful to you if you can answer in chat box. We can invite a few questions from audience if they would like to interact with Professor Nishit Kumar, sir. Anyone would like to interact with him? Yes. And I welcome Professor Yasir, sir, from King Saud University, Saudi Arabia. Greetings from India, sir. Mafat here.
Yes, tell me.
Hello, sir.
Hello, Mafat. Thank you for inviting me.
Greetings from India, sir.
Hello, not listening.
So there are a few questions from Dr. Kumar, from Mr. Vijay Kumar. Which one is best for shoot regeneration, that is TDZ or BAP? Then second question is...
Actually, this...
Yes, sir, please.
First, listen to the answer of this question.
Yes.
TDZ is one of the important dose regulator in case of the regeneration. If your objective is a regeneration, as per my experience, TDZ, as compared to BAP, is the TDZ, one of the potent cytokine for the regeneration.
Okay. Sir, I have one more question because Professor Yasir is here. He has published excellent review on the TDZ, means
yes,
abnormality of tissue culture due to TDZ. That
yes,
was published, I think, in Plant Cell Report or Planta.
Very good.
And he's present as a panelist in this meeting. Sir, is it possible to highlight few things about TDZ? Yasir, sir, if possible. Professor Yasir, sir. Okay.
Yeah, sir, I think they published one book on the TDZ from the in Springer.
Yes, and he has published also.
Yes, I have contributed one or two chapters in that book. I think that the sir is from the AMU.
Yes, no, Yasir sir is from King Saud University, Saudi Arabia.
That's a Saudi Arabia, Yasir sir. I think he's published one book on TDZ, especially on the TDZ.
Yes, he has several publications on his reading.
Of course, there is another.
Okay. And next question is from Mr. Hitesh Nakum. Ammonium nitrate is banned in India and many countries. So, what?
There is a problem nowadays. There is a problem of the ammonium nitrate. No,
yes.
There is issue on ammonium nitrate. This is explosive in nature. So right now we are using the ready-made media of the MS medium for the tissue culture.
Even I am using calcium nitrate as alternative of ammonium nitrate, Mr. Yuvraj.
Calcium nitrate, we can use the potassium nitrate also using, no issue.
Yes.
But at present, there is issue on the using the ammonium nitrate.
Yes. Next question is, same question has been asked by Yuvraj Singh Wala and Hitesh Nakum. That why ammonium nitrate is it is banned in, so what are the alternatives? Next question is from Kamil Hassan. How efficient would be domestic pressure cooker for autoclaving? So
there is no issue. Earlier people were using the pressure cooker.
Yes.
Earlier people are using in place of autoclave, people are using the pressure cooker.
Yes. So thank you very much, sir. So very few questions have been asked for this session. So I would like to summarize the session. Dr. Nishit Kumar has described the application of transgenic technology to crop improvement with several case studies. from his own lab and his own work. This is a really fantastic thing. Dr. Kumar has started his presentation with importance of plant tissue culture, followed by basic methodology and organogenetic pathways. Yes, this is very important, because until and unless audience will understand the basic key concept that how tissue culture is start, then it is very difficult to understand for school children. So here we have few school children also. So fantastic work, sir. Dr. Kumar has presented several case studies on regeneration pathways of Jatropha and stevia. Along with, he has presented his own work as a case study on transgenic technology on Jatropha and stevia. So thank you very much for, sir, for being part of this conference and accepting our invitation. So on behalf of GSX University, I, Dr. Mufattal Khair, conclude afternoon morning session. See you all in the afternoon session at 1 p.m. Indian Standard Time. So thank you very much, all of you, for being part of this conference. Thank you very much. See you in next 1 hour.